The Mets haven't quite been all around the world since they were last at Shea, but it sure feels that way. A road trip in which all of their big guys struggled, and now the Mets come home to Shea Stadium to take on Ron Gartenheuer and the perennial AL Central champion Minnesota Twins, featuring the defending batting champ and MVP in the American League. At Shea Stadium in New York, the New York Mets play the Minnesota Twins. This Mets game on SNY is presented in high definition by IO Digital Cable, the leader in HD. Do you see in HD? And a pleasant good evening, everybody, and welcome to Shea Stadium. Gary Cohen, Ron Darling with you tonight as the Mets begin the final week of interleague play, their first of three against the Minnesota Twins. The Mets have lost 11 of 13. They're in first place, but staggering somewhat, and take on a Minnesota team that's won the AL Central four of the last 5 years and waiting to get their engines charged.
Yeah, the Mets are world weary. They're happy to be at home, but they go against a Twins team that at this time last year went on a roll and had the best record in baseball. But when you look at Ron Gartenheuer's crew, he has one of the best pitching coaches in baseball, and Rick Anderson, both former Mets. But they're not doing with smoke and mirrors. Gary mentioned they got a batting title winner in Joe Mauer, MVP in Justin Morneau, Johan Santana, who pitches tomorrow, two Cy Young. So they've got a great team in Minnesota. They just haven't gelled yet.
And with Santana going tomorrow, maybe that increases the urgency for this game a little bit more as the Mets take on the former Philly, Carlos Silva, who's coming off one of the best games in his career his last time out.
Yeah, Carlos Silva is one of those big guys that really eats up a lot of innings for these Minnesota Twins. He really has only got a little over 3 runs a game and run support from the Twins. That's probably why his record is so skewed. But he learned a little sinker in spring training and a split finger, and he's getting more outs earlier in the count.
John Maine goes back to the mound for the Mets. Now, Maine's just 1-4 in his last 6 starts, but most of those games have been quality starts, and the Mets need some quality from Maine tonight.
Yeah, and he's pitched better. He's not walking people like he was early in the year, but he was the pitcher of the month in April, so those numbers have come down a little bit, but he's still been outstanding for the Mets.
So the Mets and Twins open a 3-game series here at Shea. The Mets hoping to get the Carloses started and get their engine started at the same time. Mets trying to bridge their way to the Twins, all coming up on SNY. Mets baseball on SNY is brought to you by Barbados, proud sponsor of the New York Mets. Experience the authentic Caribbean. By Aflac, ask about it at work. By Acura, advance. By 1408, based on the terrifying story by Stephen King, in theaters everywhere, Friday, June 22nd. By Ford and your tri-state Ford dealers. By GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. Visit geico.com or call 1-800-947-AUTO. And by IO Digital Cable, the leaders in HD and presenting sponsor of the Mets in high definition. Do you see in HD? This year, when you can't be home to watch your Mets on SNY or CW11, check out MLB.tv. Watch every out-of-market Mets game of the season live. Catch those you missed on demand or listen to every radio broadcast. Sign up today. Visit Mets.com, where baseball is always on. Let's check out our Jeep around the majors. Barry Bonds now just 7 away from Hank Aaron after homering off Tim Wakefield yesterday. The Orioles, first managerial firing of the year. Sam Perlaza replaced on an interim basis by Dave Tremblay. And Frank Thomas breaks Edgar Martinez's record for home runs by a DH.
You know, in defense of Sammy Perlaza, that ownership group for the Orioles should really look in the mirror.
Well, they are bound to make some other changes there, too. Rumors that Andy McPhail is going to take over at the helm of the front office there. The Mets trying to fetch a win against the Twins. All the action coming up. John Maine bids for his 7th win of the year as he faces the Minnesota Twins. Your Twins forward lineup. Luis Castillo, the former Marlin, at the top of the lineup. Last year's American League batting champ Joe Mauer hits second, and last year's American League MVP Justin Morneau hits cleanup. Pending free agent, 6-time Gold Glove winner Torrey Hunter hitting 5th. It's an interesting top of the batting order to be sure for the Twins against John Maine.
Well, John Maine has been outstanding all year. 11 of his 13 starts, 3 earned runs or less. On 4 days rest, his ERA is 5. He's getting 5 days rest today, and it's 3.47 on that kind of rest.
Luis Castillo, 0 for his last 12, but he loves coming to Shea Stadium. Slaps one foul. In fact, Castillo, the former Marlin, has hit in 32 consecutive games here at Shea, which is the longest hitting streak for any player, Met or otherwise, in the history of this ballpark. And Maine gets ahead of him 1-2.
Castillo, when he played with the Marlins, most of the time hit second behind Juan Pierre, but he is much better suited to being a leadoff hitter. 2-2 to Castillo.
Well, look at this outfield defense. Ricky Ledee, whoa. That's like you would play a pitcher that shallow.
Well, Castillo's got 489 at-bats without hitting a home run. And virtually all of the home runs in his career have come as a right-handed batter.
You know what I like about Castillo is early in his career, as you see Joe Mauer in the on-deck circle, he was a guy that had trouble hitting early in his career and learned how to bunt, how to hit the ball on the ground, and use that speed.
And that's his game, slap and fly. And he has had a very nice career. Quietly, he's won 3 gold gloves. Good leadoff hitter. See, much better left-hand hitter than right so far this year. And he slaps one to short. Reyes will have to hurry. And he throws out Castillo by a stride, one away. So one out and nobody on.
Well, here's the defense for the Mets. Leduca's still in there, even though with that bad tricep. New York has 30 errors this year, about the same as Minnesota, who leads the American League. Minnesota has 31 errors. And Reyes and Wright on that left side, 53 steals. That's the most in baseball.
Well, here is Mauer, who missed about 5 weeks with a strained left quad. He's been back for about 10 days, and he hasn't really hit since coming back. And Mauer takes a strike. Mauer, who grew up in the Twin Cities, and he's grown since he came to the Twins. He used to be 6'4". He's more like 6'6 now as he golfs one foul. And the questions always come up about Mauer, whether, even though he's a solid defensive catcher, whether he's ever going to have to be moved out from behind the plate.
Problem is, as more know, the MVP plays first base. I mean, where are you going to put him?
There you see, last year, Mauer became the first catcher ever to win an American League batting title. 1-2 to Mauer, and of course this year Jorge Posada is threatening to do the same. Mauer receiving his Silver Slugger Award, emblematic of hitting excellence. And he hits one to center field, hit well. Beltran going back to the track and has just enough room to make the grab, two away. Beltran had to make a couple of those at Yankee Stadium last night.
Well, you see Beltran pretty straight up there in center field. And that ball carried on him, because I think at first he thought he had that was a, what does Keith call it, a can of corn, but it ended up being a ball that got him all the way to the warning track.
So two out and nobody on. And here's Michael Kadire. And he pops the first pitch foul. Kadire, part of that Virginia Beach contingent, of which David Wright is a charter member. Kadire's about 4 years older than Wright, but they grew up within minutes of each other down in that Norfolk, Virginia Beach area. And a two-strike count to Kadire. So Maine has come out throwing strikes tonight. Line the other way, and a base hit for Kadire. So a two-out single. And the Twins have their first base runner.
Well, not the pitch that John Maine certainly wants to throw on an 0-2 count. Want to get that really eye high or outside and away from Kadire. Good hitting by him going the other way, though.
So here's Justin Morneau, who, when last he took his place in the batting box, hit a walk-off home run against the Brewers yesterday at the Metrodome. His third walk-off home run of the season. Takes a strike, and here it is. After the Twins had blown a 7-run lead, Morneau made up for it by cranking one off the football seats in that monstrosity of a stadium to win it 10-9. Morneau with 20 home runs this year, as Maine gets ahead of him with the fastball 0-2.
Playing baseball there is like playing baseball in a garage. As you see, John Maine, good fastball, beats Justin Morneau as these hitters are trying to get adjusted to the Maine, although he did face them, his first appearance in the big leagues was against the Twins, was a start, and was a start against Carlos Silva.
3 years ago, that was in Camden Yards, and Maine lasted just 3 2/3 and lost that game 7-3, but a lot of water has passed under the bridge since then. Now you see Morneau second behind A-Rod in American League home runs. He He's hit 99 home runs now in his career. And Maine goes with the breaking ball on 0-2, and he fouls it off. Torrey Hunter hitting fifth in the order, waiting on deck. The Twins right now a game above 500 at 34-33 in a very competitive American League Central. Cleveland leads that division by one game over Detroit and 5.5 over the Twins. Maine ahead 0-2. And Morneau watches high 1-2. The big surprise in that AL Central has been the disappointing White Sox, who just have been falling like a rock.
We just have had trouble generating runs.
Goodyear at first and two down. And Maine misses up and in, 2-2. John in his last start got beat by the Dodgers, 4-1. Went 5 1/3 in that game. And over his last six starts, he's just 1-4. It's a different look. 2-2 to Morneau. Justin Morneau, a native of Canada. His first ever game in the big leagues, he batted back-to-back in the lineup with Corey Koski, also a native of Canada. First time in big league history that two Canadians had batted back-to-back in a batting order. There goes Kadire. It's lifted to left center. A long run for Beltran in the gap, and he runs it down to end the inning. Now Beltran had to turn it into a third gear that time to run down that ball and turn the Twins aside at the top of the first. 28-year-old Venezuelan Carlos Silva on the mound for the Twins facing this Geico Mets lineup. Paul LaDuca right back in there tonight after taking that pitch off the triceps last night from Chenming Wang. And Jose Reyes takes a strike from Silva.
Silva's the kind of pitcher, give you a lot of innings, also gives up tons of hits. Last year, 246 hits and 180 1/3 innings pitched.
And the breaking ball misses high to Reyes, 1-1. Jose was a force in the first two games of the series at Yankee Stadium, stealing five bases in those two games. But had trouble getting on base last night, even hitting into a double play, something that happens very rarely, especially from the left side of the plate for Jose. Pulled on the ground, down to first, and handled by Morneau for the first out. So Reyes retired, one away.
The catcher.
Well, here's the Rico defense. Joe Mauer doing the catching. Hunter, the gold glover in center field. Michael Kadire in right field, 14 outfield assists. Jason Bartlett, shortstop, with 12 errors so far this season.
Here's LaDuca, who was certainly questionable tonight. You see he's wearing a little larger pad over his elbow and his triceps where he got drilled last night. He was wearing a light pad the last few games because he's gotten hit in the same area three or four times this season. But he's gone to a little thicker substance to take away a little more of the shock if he gets it there again.
You just got to love LaDuca. You knew he was going to be in there. Just one of those guys that, you know, there's a lot of players that would not play as hurt as he plays every day.
1-1 to Paul. This is last night as Wong came inside. And I'm just above the elbow. And you can hear that it hit the pad, but it didn't seem to help. There's that cumulative effect of all those hits in the same spot. He's been hit by a bat there once this year and by several pitches. Reaches for it and taps it over the mound. Bartlett moving to his left. And the low throw handled by Morneau for the second out.
The center fielder.
See it already. 2-1 pitch to Reyes, a little changeup. 2-1 pitch to the 1-1 pitch to LaDuca. The little kind of slider that he took a little speed off. That's what Silva will do, back and forth, change speeds on all of his pitches.
Well, here's Beltran, who has been the subject of much discussion over the last couple of days in terms of his relative health. Certainly his bat is not healthy right now, and that's true of many Mets, but and Beltran's been back for 10 games since sitting out a few days with a knee problem, and he's just 8-53 since returning. But, you know, he's told reporters that he's 75 to 80%. And Willie Randolph says, look, he's just sore. He's been sore since spring training, but he's playable. And he lines it to short, and it's caught by Bartlett, side retired. And, you know, Willie insists there's no communication gap. It's just a matter of people are asking Beltran questions, and he's being honest. No score as we go to the second. Weekday mornings, before you head out the door, check out the CW11's commuter cast. From traffic tie-ups to train delays, get up to the minute time-saving traffic reports with commuter cast all morning long on the CW11 morning news. Torrey Hunter leads off the second inning and takes ball one from John Maine. Hunter having a terrific season. 14 homers, 54 RBIs. And he was questionable tonight as he hits the two-hopper to right. Grabs it at the midsection. High throw, and Delgado, wearing those pants hiked up tonight, able to stay on the bag.
Well, nice how he gave in. See, Wright gives in that little hop, kind of cradles that ball into his midsection, and able to get that and get Hunter at first base. Nice footwork by Carlos Delgado. See? Just kind of give a little bit. That makes your hands soft, cradle in your midsection. You had plenty of time to get Hunter.
So one out and nobody on. Here's Jason Kubel, the left fielder, and he takes a strike. The top part of the Minnesota batting order is formidable. Once you get past Hunter, there's not a whole lot of juice in this lineup, and it's the reason why the Twins are 10th out of 14 teams in runs scored in the American League. There's Nick Punto on deck.
There's Ronald Clyde Gardenhire.
Ron was a shortstop for the Mets during his playing days, and he has been a worthy successor to Tom Kelly at the helm of the Minnesota Twins, who've had just two managers in the last 21 years.
It's kind of funny, when they were my teammates in AAA ball, if you'd have asked me if of the teammates I had on those Tidewater teams who would be a manager someday, he was one, and Bruce Bochy was the other, and both managing in the big leagues.
Struck him out. Good high fastball by Maine, and he strikes out Kubel for his first of the night.
Well, good high fastball. We've already seen in Maine's short career that when he's upstairs like that, the hitters just cannot catch up to that kind of life that he has in that fastball.
So two out and nobody on. Here's Nick Punto. And there's been a lot of talk in Minnesota over the last few days about what the Twins need to make a run in the AL Central, and what is on the top of their list is a third baseman. Now, Nick Punto is a terrific backup player. Good speed, good defensive player, but they feel like they need a bat. Check swing roller, and Loduca pounces on it and makes the play. Nice pick by Delgado, reaching into the runner. And a 1-2-3 inning for John Maine. So Loduca making the accurate throw, and Delgado nicely grabbing. David Wright leads off the home second inning against Carlos Silva. David's 17-game hitting streak came to an end last night. And he takes a strike from Silva. One and one to Wright, with Delgado and Green to follow. Carlos going with a little different look tonight with the uniform. As Bartlett throws out Wright for the first out, one away.
Well, it's a nice play by Loduca on this swinging bunt from Punto. Watch what Loduca does with that right foot. You almost try to step on the ball, because why do you do that? One, you never will step on it. But when you try to step on the ball, that brings your right arm right down to where the ball is, and you'll never miss it. Try to step on it, gather it up with that bare hand. That's only on a bare hand play now, kids out there. But if you have a ball that's stopped, you want to pick it up with your bare hand, try to step on it with your right foot if you're right-handed. Pick it up and make the throw.
Here's Delgado, and he takes a strike from Silva.
I learned that from Mike Boddicker, if anyone out there remembers the fine Baltimore Oriole, Boston Red Sox. The Baltimore Orioles, who were very well-schooled in fundamentals. That was one of their things that they used in spring training, and I asked him about it. I was watching the field one day. He says that's what he did. I started to do it, and it really made a big difference.
Loduca doing a little glove work there.
In the air to right field, hit a mile high. Is it deep enough? Kadir back near the wall, and it's out of here. Carlos Delgado with his 11th home run of the year, a towering blast. And the Mets go in front 1-0. So Delgado gets the Mets started. And here is Sean Green. And Sean takes a strike.
Well, trying to come inside on Carlos Delgado. That ball drifts back over the plate. And with those high socks, maybe a little change for Delgado with that towering shot.
That ball stayed in the air a long, long time before landing on the bullpen platform out there. Green takes away 1-2.
Did that almost get our friend Tom Nieto again?
Well, he had enough time to get out of the way. I think it's once bitten, twice shy out there.
Over the mound, toward the middle, Bartlett has it, spins, fires, safe.
That was a tremendous effort by Jason Bartlett, but Green barely able to beat it for an infield hit.
You know, I mentioned when we were doing the defense that he has 12 errors. What I didn't mention is that the Twins have been so happy with his defensive play, with his range, and you saw it right there. Just gets it in his glove. He said he put his glove behind him because the ball had beat him, and makes that perfect throw, and just by a eyelash, Green gets in safe.
Well, for Sean Green, that snaps an 0-for-13 streak, and the Mets have a one-out base runner for Valentin. But, you know, the Twins have been a team throughout this run of success they've had over the last half decade that has so prided themselves on defense and fundamentals. And you talked about the Orioles, and you look at the Orioles and what that franchise has become, and you look at what the Twins have accomplished trying to be like the Orioles used to be 25, 30 years ago.
Yeah, up and down the system, they're all taught the same way from single-A ball. They practice the same things that the Twins do here in the big leagues.
Valentin pops it up, and Morneau coming down the line. Two away.
And you know what was interesting today? You were mentioning that a lot of the Twins, an inordinate amount of Twins, as you see the errors, 31, were on the subway today, together, coming to the ballpark at 2:30. They were all out here. There were 12 guys for early hitting. Unheard of. If you have four or five guys, that's a lot. And then after they hit, they went to first base, where Ron Gardenhire was given a little base running clinic. Those are the little things, attention to detail, that makes the Twins such a solid organization.
Here's Ricky Ledee, and he grounds one to the second baseman, Castillo. He'll make the sidearm toss look like he had an easier play at second, but he opted to go to first. Castillo makes the play to end the inning. But Carlos Delgado, new style on the pants and socks, and it pays off in his first at bat with his 11th home run, 1-0 New York. Well, we've got a brand new sponsor for our SNY text poll, thanks to the folks at Toyota. Of these players, who do you think is the best home run hitter of all time? Bonds, Ruth, Aaron, Mantle. Sammy Sosa and Mark McGwire aren't on that list. Sammy just a home run away from 600 for his career. He'll become the fifth all time. Didn't see Willie Mays' name on that list either. Jason Bartlett takes a strike. That's very interesting that Mantle snuck into that quartet.
Yeah, well, New York. He would have a New York name, I guess. Well, they have Babe there.
Willie played here. Slow ground ball, right. Lex to pick it up in fair territory and scoop by Delgado, but too late, and Bartlett beats it out. Well, if Wright had let that ball continue, it might well have gone foul, but he thought he could make the play and came up a little bit short.
Well, another swinging bunt. Two in a row now, and this one down the line, and this would definitely go foul. Boy, it looks like he was out at first base, but that's just me. If you field it there, it's halfway down the line. And, yeah, well, he was out. So, to the naked eye and the replay. Oh, not even close.
And that's not even close. John Hirschbeck, the first base umpire, just a bad call. And no objection from the Mets, interestingly enough, as Silva goes up there looking to bunt, and he takes a strike.
Well, you know, we were talking about that play. So, if David lets it go, it'll go foul. The only way you pick it up is you know you have to play it first. He did have to play it first. Good decision by Wright.
And that's a significant margin right there. Silva swinging. Guy who has 19 at-bats in his career. Remember, when he was in the National League, he was a relief pitcher, so he didn't get to bat all that much.
Well, this is called the old butcher boy. If you fake like you're going to bunt, and then when Wright's coming in very hard, he's trying to hit a ground ball.
Is it ever called the butcher boy without being called the old butcher boy?
Yeah, I don't think so.
And Silva lays off, and it's 1-2. Silva giving himself up, and he bunts a fair ball. Maine's play will have to go to first, and so the sacrifice successful with two strikes. 1-4 on the sack moves Bartlett to second with one away.
Well, fundamentally sound Minnesota Twins. Pitcher who doesn't even hit in American League gets the bunt down. Nice job on that slider.
You know, it was very interesting looking at stats provided by the Elias Sports Bureau. This was a couple of days ago that, you know, the National League and the American League, it's been kind of lopsided the last couple of years. In fact, going into today in interleague play, the American League has won 91 games in the National League 77. And they looked at a couple of areas, and one of them was DH. And the DH in the American League was out hitting the DH for the National League in those interleague games by 100 points. But, and you'd figure that, right? Because
yeah.
National League teams don't have a guy who is strictly a DH. But the thing that made no sense at all is that American League pitchers were out hitting National League pitchers by like 70 points. How do you figure that? Castillo slaps it foul, and it's 0-2.
They're just so happy to have a bat in their hands. They can't wait. There's an interleague play.
Now, overall, you know, the American League dominated last year, and they've certainly had the edge so far this year. The Mets are 4-5 in interleague play. The Twins are 7-5. 0-2 to Castillo, who's hard to strike out. To shortstop, the runner will have to hold. Reyes plays that curling grounder and throws out Castillo for the second out. So two away. Now here's Bauer, who drove Beltran deep into center field with a fly ball his first time up. Tying run at second and two out, and Bauer takes low and in. Joe Mauer this spring, after winning the batting title, signed a 4-year, $33 million contract. That buys out his arbitration years and takes him into what would have been free agency. The Twins are a small market team, and generally they draft, develop, and play players from their own organization. Then they have to decide which ones to reward and try to keep, like Mauer. They've got a big decision coming up regarding Torrey Hunter, who will be a free agent after this year.
Torrey, 31 years old, at that age where you know he's going to have many good years to come, but how many years will he have at that excellent play that he has been? 31 home runs last season.
Mauer takes inside, ball four. So, Maine thought he had a strike there, but instead issues his first walk of the night.
Interesting call by Laz Diaz, the home plate umpire. There used to be a day before Questec, it was 3-0 and it was close, it was a strike. Those days are gone.
Didn't they used to call that the automatic?
The automatic. get it close, and it makes the game go quicker also.
So here's Kadire, who singled to right his first time up. Two out and two on, 1-0 New York. The Mets have had a habit of scoring first over this dry period that they've gone through. They didn't score first last night, but it has been their pattern. Maine, in his last start, got an early 1-0 lead and then couldn't hold it.
They just need to get in the habit of keeping that lead. That's the problem, this bad streak of 13 games.
Or build bigger leads. Slider misses, and it's 2-0 to Kadire. And the weird thing about this stretch is that, you know, the Mets had the two games in Detroit where they scored 7 runs and lost. They had another game Saturday at Yankee Stadium. They scored 8 runs and lost. As Kadire fouls it back. But in most of the games in this streak, the Mets really haven't hit.
Yeah.
And they haven't scored runs.
Well, I mean, it gets overshadowed. The game on Friday night, Oliver Perez, fantastic game. Win for the Mets. Scored 2 runs.
See, there are the averages for the road trip, 3.8. But remember, that includes 2 sevens and an 8.
Yeah.
In a 9-game road trip. Kadire pops it up in foul ground. And when you score 22 runs in 3 games and lose all 3, that's not a good sign, because it means your team is out of sync.
You'll see that reliever's ERA. Boy, 6.38. And also, don't you feel, it's hard to judge runs after your team's been blown out.
Mm-hmm. 2-2 to Kadire. Slider hit toward the hole, cut off by Wright. They'll have to go to first, and he gets Kadire to end the inning. He had a mind to go to second, but Maurer was quick getting down the line, and so Wright had to adjust and got the final out of the inning to keep the Mets in the lead, 1-0. Jerry White, the Twins' first base and outfield coach, as John Main leads off in the home third inning. And some people say, oh, what do first base coaches do? Well, they can be encouraging.
Well, what happens, right, when he decides to come to first, see, White, he's clapping, trying to get Kadire like he was hoping for his racehorse to win.
We used to do that coaching Little League all the time. It's Morneau makes the unassisted play on Main for the first out. You don't see that in the big leagues all that often.
You know, one thing I had to learn when I started coaching my son's Little League team, there's the most important word in Little League coaching that wasn't when I was there.
Run.
Focus.
Focus.
Right? Every kid. Come on now, guys. Let's focus.
Here's Reyes with one out. And Jose drops down a bunt. Maurer on it, but it's a foul ball. Very close to being fair. But Maurer didn't bother to wait to ask the question. He got on it as quick as he could.
Well, Reyes, because he has such great speed, he's able to tip his hand earlier than most bunters. And I think that gives him a great advantage, because it allows him to stay still, place the ball where he wants to, and then go. As you'll see, guys who don't have as much speed, they have to disguise it more.
And again, he shows bunt, trying to bring those corners in as Punto came charging hard from third. One and two to Reyes. Loduca back in the 2 spot in the batting order last night for the first time since late April, as Willie Randolph basically used everybody else on the team in that spot before getting back to Loduca. Up the middle, Bartlett to his left, won't get this one. And Reyes has a one-out single. Jose falls down as he makes his turn and able to scramble back. Let's check in with Kevin Burkhardt. Kevin?
You know, guys, I heard you talking before about the Mets' recent slump, and I figured a good person to talk to would be Aaron Sealy. He was a doctor last year when they lost 13-14 in the middle of July, but right after that, they won 17 of 18 games. You want to talk about not getting too high or too low? He told me that's a big reason why you have a veteran clubhouse, because guys know it's over the long haul, and he said it's also a big reason why you have a routine. It kind of keeps you grounded. You don't get too down, you don't get too up, and he feels it's the same way with this team. He knows, and the team knows, they're not playing well right now, but he said it's very similar to last year. All these guys are very even keel, so he was pretty confident, guys, that they'll come out of it. Maybe not right away, but he says it'll come.
Well, it is a very long season. but 11 out of 13 is still tough to stomach. As Loduca takes a strike.
That's one thing that I think for fans out there, when a team's on a winning streak, you'll see players and go, boy, they're not as excited as they should be. They won 10 in a row. How come they're not jumping up and down? Well, ball players know that what goes around comes around at some point, so you don't want to get too crazy when you're on a winning streak because you don't want to get too down when you're in a streak like the Mets are in now.
Slowly hit, past Punto. Bartlett has no play at second, but still has enough time to get Loduca at first.
But watch on this play, Punto almost really gets in front of Bartlett. That's why he was not able to get that ball out of his glove and try to go to second. Also slipped on the sand there, but of course had enough time to get Loduca at first base.
So now two out, Reyes at second, and Beltran will try and get him in. Carlos lined out to short his first time up. And he pulls one down to first. Marino knocks it down and makes the play on Beltran to end the inning. So Beltran first pitch swinging, grounds out, strands Reyes. We're through three at Shea. The Mets with a 1-0 lead. The Cyclones are Brooklyn. Secure your tickets for the opening week of the Cyclones 2007 season today at brooklyncyclones.com. Justin Morneau pops the first pitch foul as we start the top of the fourth. Morneau fly to center his first time up. Justin Morneau wearing number 33 against John Main. Wearing number 33. Morneau wears 33 in tribute to Patrick Roy. Of course, he grew up in Canada, and Morneau was a hockey player as a kid. Huge Roy fan. And didn't get the number immediately when he came to the Twins. J.C. Romero had it, but when Romero left and was traded to the Angels, Morneau jumped on it. Pulls that one foul, 2-2.
Does Roy have the most playoff wins? I mean, one of the great goalies. I think he has the most playoff wins. Maybe the New Jersey Devils goalie, Martin Brodeur, he must have a lot also.
Morneau takes it low, and it's 3-2. Morneau, does he remind you at all of another great Canadian player? Larry Walker?
Yeah, he does. He does. Kind of the Tommy Hawk kind of style of hitting.
And he takes a walk, leading off in the fourth. Second walk given up by Maine. Well, here's your Mets upcoming schedule. Two more with the Twins, then three over the weekend with the Oakland A's. Looks like Mike Piazza will not be back in time because they're grooming him to be a catcher now. Then the Cardinals come in for four before the Mets go to Philadelphia for that day-night doubleheader on the 29th. Remember, all Mets home games on SNY are available in HD, presented by IO Digital Cable. Do you see in HD? Here's Torrey Hunter, who grounded out to David Wright his first time up. Tying run at first, and he fouls it back. It's fascinating because the A's had said that Mike was not going to catch. His catching days were over. He was going to be strictly a DH. He got hurt. And while he was hurt, Jack Cust took over as the DH and went on a tear. And now all of a sudden they're saying that Mike's going to do some catching when he comes back.
Well, the problem is Jason Kendall was below the Mendoza line for most of the season.
0-2 to Hunter.
Although Kendall's picked it up a little bit.
Even hit a home run the other
yes.
day. But it's going to be interesting to see how Mike makes the transition after having basically shut it down as a defensive player. Morneau a short lead, and the slider just misses to Hunter, 1-2. But it's a shame that he's not going to be off the disabled list in time to play, because remember how huge it was last year yes. when Piazza came back to Shea as a member of the Padres. 1-2 to Hunter, popped up. Playable for Loduca. Sheds the mask, makes the grab. The mask was heading in a beeline toward Laz Diaz, who had to take evasive action.
And this is what you do as a catcher. You hold on to that mask till you find where the ball is, then you toss it away. That way you won't step on it while you're trying to make that catch.
So one out and one on. And here's Jason Kubel, the left fielder. Kubel struck out his first time up. The Twins are hoping at some point this season of getting some service out of Rondell White, who is the Twins' equivalent of Moises Alou, the guy you bring in and hope that he stays healthy. And right now, neither one is. Here's a strike, and it's one and one.
Moises Alou, who now is halfway through a shutdown period. I think it's 10 days of being shut down completely. He's on day five. Then when he comes off at a day 10, he's going to go down to Florida and start to work himself back into shape.
Two and one, the count to Kubel. And it's hard to judge these things because so many parts affect other parts. But the Mets survived after Alou got hurt and were able to muddle along. And even though their offensive numbers were down a little bit, they continued to win. Then Andy Chavez got hurt. And from the day Andy got hurt, the Mets have gone to a tailspin. Now, is it cause and effect? Is it just the cumulative effect of all the things that happened to Mets outfielders? But that's the reality. From the day that Chavez got hurt in that game against the Phillies on the last homestand, the Mets have struggled to win. 2-2 to Kubel. Struck him out. Maine strikes out Kubel for the second time. Two away.
And the second time on a fastball up. As Kubel could not catch up to that fastball from Maine. You know, Gary, you mentioned Eddie Chavez since that day. I think it was a dagger through the heart of the Mets in that game, that entire game, as far as Rollins hitting that big home run off Heilman.
That was the top of the inning. Then in the bottom of the inning, Chavez grounded into a double play and got hurt. The Mets really haven't been the same since.
Right up the middle, Rollins with the double play. And, of course, Chavez just trying to turn it up a notch. Hamstring now.
And that's 2 weeks ago, and Mets have lost 11 of 13 in the intervening time. And, you know, it's interesting because when Andy first went down, well, they said 4 to 6 weeks. Now it looks like it's going to be on the high side and that they may not get him back till well after the All-Star break. 1-1 to Punto. And he can't catch up with the fastball, 1-2.
Well, our colleague Keith Hernandez, who's had those injuries, as we see the swing from Punto this late. And it looks like he's trying to hit it the other way, but see those eyes? It's almost like he's trying to direct that ball to right.
Now that one off LaDuca. That get him on the other arm?
No. Just taking a beating. Right shoulder, it looked like. The umpire's great, Laz Diaz here. He will bring the ball out, he'll dust the plate off, he'll ask LaDuca, is he all right? Pat him on the helmet, and away we go, because the umpires, if anyone knows what it feels like to get those comebackers, it's the umpire.
1-2 to Punto, up and away, and it's 2-2. Popped up, Wright retreats. David has the call, and he has the ball, and the inning is over. So a leadoff walk. Maine gets the next three on two pop-ups and a strikeout. So Maine's thrown up four zeros, and the Mets have a 1-0 lead. Home fourth inning, David Wright leads off against Carlos Silva, and he hits it in the air to center field. Right there is Hunter to make the grab. That ball knuckled on him a little bit, but he stayed with it. One pitch and one out. Carlos Delgado has been responsible for the only run of this game. It was our Coors Light Cold Blast in the second inning. He hit it a mile high, and onto that bullpen bench as Tom Nieto got out of the way this time. You see him duck?
I did.
It's a nice move.
He's a catcher. Catch the thing.
I don't think he was wearing his glove. One early in the season went off the strikeout board and hit him in the back of the head. There's the strike to Delgado, who now has 11 home runs and 41 RBIs. The 41 RBIs lead the team despite all of Carlos's struggles this year. 1-1.
Incoming.
And the chief is able to take evasive action. Here he is. That's catching instructor Tom Nieto. Delgado lays off and it's 2-1. And he lines that one for a base hit. So Delgado is 2-for-2.
Well, these Sox are going to stay high all year long if he hits the ball like this. This ball, changeup away and down, and that's a good sign that that change of pace there, he's still able to keep his weight back and still hit that line drive.
What I found fascinating in that sequence is that the Twins were playing Torrey Hunter a few steps to left center. I mean, playing Delgado like he was a left field hitter, and yet, you know, there's Silva throwing off speed pitches. Here's Sean Green, who takes the changeup outside. Look where Hunter is.
Yeah, Hunter's playing to the right side like it's a right-handed hitter up. I think what happens in the charts in a lot of books, Gary, is that on the ground, he'll tend to pull. In the air, he'll tend to hit straight away or the opposite way.
But you would figure if a guy's going to throw soft,
yeah,
that he's going to be pulling the ball, right?
Well, that's the problem, is that if the center fielder, some defenses, the shortstop will see the sign and reach behind him and give a little sign to the outfield, let him know something soft's coming, so maybe he can make that adjustment.
Green hits one to left center field, hit well. Hunter racing back. It's over his head and off the base of the wall. Delgado to third. He'll be held up there. Green into second with a double. And the Mets have second and third and one out.
Well, you see Torrey Hunter playing a little to the left of second base. So he's in the right position. It's just that ball is scalded by Sean Green. That was a break right there for the Minnesota Twins. Hit the base, came right back to Hunter, and you can see Delgado. And that's kind of the new way now, is as you're running, they look over their shoulder, almost like they're coaching themselves around the bases.
When you look over your shoulder, it slows you down.
It absolutely does, but everyone does it. I don't know when it started, but.
Infield halfway, Valentin the batter, and he pulls one foul. Valentin fouled out to the first baseman his first time.
So he's kind of looking at it. See, kind of coaching himself. Usually when you're running around those bases, you want to pick up Sandy Alomar, and he'll tell you whether to stay or go, because a lot of times you'll be running around and you don't see it, but the outfielder will drop the ball as going to pick it up, and that's when he restarts you. So you want to have your eye on that third base coach.
Throw to third by Maurer, and Delgado has to hit the dirt. I mean, the whole point is supposed to be that you run as hard as you can to put pressure on the defense, and then if somebody does drop the ball at the fence or on the relay, then you can score.
Yeah, if you're at first base, you see the ball's over his head, so you're just running as hard as you can, pick up Sandy, and he'll let you know.
1-1 to Valentin, and it's dribbled foul. So now Silva in a spot where he needs a strikeout. He's not a strikeout pitcher. He's averaged about 3.5 strikeouts per 9 innings.
Yeah, he won't walk you, and he won't strike you out. Gives up a lot of base hits. He hasn't been hurt by the home run ball this year as he has in the past.
So Valentin's got to put the ball in play here and at least try and get Delgado home from third with one out. And Valentin hits it to the shortstop. Delgado coming home. Bartlett's throw coming home, and he's out at the plate. So Bartlett playing halfway, able to throw Delgado out for the second out.
Interesting. These are the kind of things you do when you're struggling to score runs. you have Carlos Delgado, not one of their fastest runners, moving on contact. Bartlett made a nice play going up the middle, throwing back across his body. And good job by Maurer making the tag. See how these catchers reach out to get it? Tried to block him with his foot, but still was able to place the tag.
Close play, as it turned out.
That's a nice fadeaway slide, they used to call that, by Delgado.
Nice to see somebody not try to slide by and slap it with their hand, right? Your foot can get there a whole lot faster than your hand can. So here's Ricky Ledee, who grounded out to second base his first trip, first and third and two out. Ledee making his fourth start since being called up. He had that one good game in Detroit where he had a pair of doubles. Swung the bat really well. Green is at third and Valentin at first with two down. And Silva misses wide. It's 2-0.
Well, Ricky Ledee was one of those players when he first came up with the Yankees. He was supposed to be the next real deal and never got untracked early, then became a bench player. And I think bench playing is not for everyone. It's hard to keep, you know, your mechanics, how to keep any rhythm sometimes on the bench.
Pulled base hit in the right field, and that'll get Green home with the second Met run. Valentin stops at second. It's an RBI single for Ricky Ledee, and it's 2-0 New York.
Well, this is one of the things that the Mets have done so well last year, was the ability that if someone did not get the runner in, Valentin unable to get Delgado in, that someone would pick up his teammate with a two-out hit. Nice job by Ledee.
And from the standpoint of the pitcher, you've got first and third and two out and the pitcher on deck. You fall behind 2-0. You want to be giving up a base hit on that pitch?
Yeah, you know what he did? He threw a changeup 2-0 and thought he would get away with it, but it was middle of the plate. And so he was trying to make a pitch that's not his fastball on 2-0. But I think if you're in a position where you do not want to let this guy hurt you, then my decision is you don't throw him a strike. I would throw that in the dirt, and then if he swung at it, then maybe I'm back in the at-bat. And if he doesn't, then he'll just proceed with a walk and face John Maine.
Now, Silva's pitched in the National League before, but he's an American League pitcher. Is there not that mindset of using the pitcher's spot to work a lineup when you're an American League pitcher?
I think it is, but that's when your pitching coach or your catcher comes out and makes sure that you know that you don't forget it in your head that, you know, the pitcher's up next. We'll try to go after and make him chase a pitch. Is Rick Anderson, the pitching coach, Andy. Started 8 games for the 1986 team. And you have to remind pitchers sometimes, especially American League pitchers.
2-0 to Maine, and he takes a strike. By the way, you didn't mention the most important fact about Rick Anderson from a Mets standpoint.
He got traded for Mr. Cone, yes. David Cone.
He and Ed Hearn and Chris Jellick, the three that went to Kansas City. 2-2 now to Maine.
Remember, they traded for Coney. He came over, struck out about 9 St. Louis hitters in spring training. We said, how did we get this guy for Eddie Hearn and Rick Anderson? Well, we got on the flight to go home. As we took off, Coney came surfing down the middle of the plane. We said, now I know how we got him. He belongs on this team.
And he went 20-3.
That's right.
Hit to the right side. And Castillo throws out Maine, who still is without his first big league RBI. But Ricky Ledee has his second of the year as Delgado picks up his second hit of the day. Green doubles into third, and a base hit by Ledee brings home a run.
Welcome back to Shea. Mets have a 2-0 lead here over the Twins, and I am joined by former Giants general manager Ernie Accorsi. Kind enough to take a couple minutes, and it sounds weird. Former Giants general manager Ernie Accorsi, do you feel a little strange right here? How does it feel?
Well, that former does sound funny. I wish it was like the military where you keep your rank and they just put retired after your name.
You know, I'll talk about baseball in a minute, but Giant fans want to know about the football. So let's talk first of all about the running back position. And, you know, do you think Brandon Jacobs, it's a pretty big burden he has to shoulder now with Tiki Barber gone. Can he be the guy to carry that load?
I have great confidence in Brandon Jacobs. I also think they made a real good acquisition in Drones. But, you know, you don't replace Tiki Barber. He's going to probably go to the Hall of Fame. And those kind of backs are not replaced. But I think Brandon Jacobs has a chance to be an outstanding player. I mean, he's got all the body movement instincts of a halfback, not a fullback, and he's big, and he can run.
How about Eli Manning? You know, what does he need to do to take that next step now, do you think?
Well, you know, the one thing about him is he's quarterback two seasons, and I mean, not, you know, this past season was a 500 season, but he's been in the playoffs twice. So, I mean, he's won games for us that are big games, and there have been patches of brilliance. And when you see it once, you know it can, you can do it again. And it's, you know, it was our obligation to get it out of him on a consistent basis. So I think he'll have a terrific career.
Did he get a bad rap?
Well, I don't know what the rap is. I mean, as far as his,
well, you know, the inconsistency thing. I mean, do you think it's, you know, it's overblown a little bit?
No, I mean, he's been up and down, but you know, he's also had a lot of weapons taken away too in his left tackle. But I think he's a competitive kid, and he's, like I said, he's been in the playoffs twice, and I think he'll win. I really believe he'll win a championship in New York.
So how much of a fan will you be this year going to Giants? I mean, will that be hard when the games start and going there on game day and not, you know, going to your office and doing work and getting ready and the whole thing is, you know, how weird will that be for you?
It is. I mean, I don't know what to expect. You know, I have no office to go to. If I want to wait till the traffic clears, I have to sit in my car. But it's going to be hard. I mean, there's still players that I'm bonded with. Plus, the franchise I will always love. And we'll see. I assume I'm going to be able to go to the games and live through it. I'm going to try anyway.
You know, you're a huge baseball fan as well as Silva, a little number that Maine's going to pick up here. You told me you're going on a big baseball trip, actually, in August. That's got to be pretty neat for you.
I love baseball. In spring training, I saw 20 games in 20 days. I try to come out here and Yankee Stadium. I'm going to Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, Detroit, Milwaukee, Chicago, St. Louis, and the site of the Field of Dreams. And I'm also going to Commerce, Oklahoma. I've always wanted to go to Mickey Mantle's hometown, so you can tell when I grew up and who I rooted for as a kid. But I'm really looking forward to it. I've always wanted to do this.
Great trip. One last one, quick, if you can. What do you think is the biggest key for the Giants this year?
Biggest
key for the Giants this year. What do you think?
I think protecting the quarterback, and if they protect the quarterback with the receivers staying healthy, I think you'll have a great year.
Arnie, it's a pleasure. Thanks for catching up with us.
Kevin, I enjoyed it.
Guys, back up to you.
All right, thanks very much, Kevin. And John Means retired the first two here in the top of the fifth, taking on Luis Castillo, who twice has grounded out to Reyes at short. And he takes a strike, 1-1. Well, I know that our producer, Greg Picker, feels fulfilled now. He is a
he
huge
loves
Giants.
Giants.
Oh, man. He bleeds big blue.
Now, how does it work? If you love the Giants, is it like baseball, then you don't like the Jets, or it's not, it's different?
I don't think it's that way for everybody. I think there are Jet fans who got Jet season tickets because they couldn't get Giant season tickets.
Okay.
But that's evolved over the years, and I think there's more animosity than there used to be as Castillo grounds out to Valentin to end the inning. So Maine on a roll now, 5 shutout innings. He's allowed just 2 hits. Before the Mets take the field, get ready for game time on SNY, because we always lead off with North Fork Bank pregame live, setting the lineup before every Mets game on SNY. Look, there's a Twins fan in New York. No, there were any of those. Jose Reyes leads off in the home fifth inning, and he drives one in the air to deep right center field. Back goes Kadire near the wall, and he picks it off. Oh, there's a tremendous play by Michael Kadire, who had to go a mile and a half and then grab it on the back end and smack into the fence to retire Reyes.
Boy, this ball just seemed to hang up in the air. I thought when it went off the bat, easy triple for Reyes. Look at that concentration by Kadire and the ability, once he smacks into that fence, to hold that ball because he did not catch it in the pocket. Nice job. Well, I'll tell you, as a pitcher, boy, you appreciate when your players go to the mat, so to say, for you, making these catches. It can change an entire game. If he doesn't make that catch, Reyes is on third, no outs. Mets almost automatically get at least a run.
Well, the extra base hits have been hard to come by lately for Reyes. He hit that home run at Yankee Stadium off Roger Clemens Friday night. But he has just 3 extra base hits in his last 27 games. As Loduca takes a strike, and that certainly looked like one coming off the bat. Loduca has grounded out twice, 0 for 2. Mets have had 6 hits off Carlos Silva. Strike 0-2. Silva starting his third time through the lineup, and that's been a problem for him. And Reyes certainly struck it well. 1-2 to Leduca.
It makes sense, though, for a control kind of pitcher, because by then you've gauged the speed of his fastball, the break of his sinker or slider, the kind of rhythm and pitch selection that he has over the course of the first couple of bats. And it's kind of funny, if you see those stats, you'll see it, that it's usually lower in the first two times of the order, higher that third time, but then it's low again in the fourth time, because very few pitchers making it to the eighth or ninth inning. And if they do, they're on top of their game.
Fouled away. And that was certainly the case for Silva in his last outing, when he went the distance and beat the Braves. One of his better outings of the year. But then the start before that, he gave up seven runs. He's been so inconsistent, really, over the course of his whole career.
And the Twins have been shut out five times this year, four times when Silva's been the starter.
Leduca fouls it away. Well, they're being shut out through five innings tonight. As you know, we talked about it in the open, the Mets have only won twice in their last 13 games, and those two have been dominating pitching performances by Sosa and Perez.
Perez's was pretty amazing. That's a tough lineup, that Yankee lineup, especially right now.
2-2 to Leduca, and he lines a base hit into right center. Now Leduca fighting off that bruised triceps, took a shot off his right shoulder earlier in the game, and he still lines a base hit.
You know, we saw him go through that streak where he was not getting any hits, and starting in the second game of the Yankee series, and now here again tonight, starting to shoot that ball to right field, Gary. And I think that's, whenever he gets in a slump, starts shooting that ball to right field. There's Oliver Perez.
So third time through the batting order against Silva, the Mets starting to find the range. And here's Beltran, who's hit two balls hard, but he's 0-2.
Grounds that one toward the middle. Castillo on a nice backhand behind the back flip for the force. Well, Castillo, the three-time Gold Glover, putting a little mustard on that one with the flip to get to Bartlett.
Wow. Not much to say there. Just a beautiful play up the middle. Steve Nash should be proud of this assist. Oh. And you know, if you watch Castillo take ground balls before a game, he always practices three or four of those. He and Alex Gonzalez, when they were in Florida,
they were
great to watch.
Alex Gonzalez now in Cincinnati. Hey, remember back in spring training, we were talking about the Red Sox signing Julio Lugo, and talking about how much money they spent on him and allowing Alex Gonzalez to walk away for a third of the price? You looked at the numbers lately?
But the lack of numbers for Lugo.
And, you know, Gonzalez is just 10 times the fielder that Lugo is. It looked like a bad signing from the first day.
Up the middle, base hit for Wright. Beltran goes to second, turns there, and he'll hold on as Hunter throws behind him, and Beltran back to the bag.
So the Mets hitting the ball well against Silva here in the fifth inning.
Well, he doesn't do anything to really surprise you, Silva. He's a strikes machine. That ball's supposed to be inside, caught a lot of the plate, and he doesn't throw hard enough to get you out inside unless he's on the corner.
So here is Delgado, who's off to a fast start tonight. He hit his 11th home run in the second inning, then singled with one out in the fourth. Here for the first time tonight, he'll bat with runners in scoring position. Over his last 50 at-bats with runners in scoring position, Delgado has six hits. Let's see if he can pick one up here. And he takes this fastball for ball one. 6 for 50, that's the fewest hits by a Met in a 50 at bat span with runners in scoring position in 5 years. But he's got the pants hiked up tonight. And now he's ahead on the count 2-0. And Maurer's going to run that ball back out to Silva. He's only thrown 67 pitches on the night.
And those first two pitches were very close, Gary. That's what you like to see with Delgado. Maybe he's seen the ball a little better tonight, because, you know, those pitches are pitcher's pitches. If you swing at them, you're going to make it out.
And that's the one thing we've seen with both Delgado and Beltran during this stretch. Neither one of them is drawing any walks at all. They've been very anxious at the plate. Very different from the way they were approaching it earlier in the year. Delgado lifts one down the left field line. A long one for Kubel over toward the line. Diving, and he made the catch. An incredible play by Jason Kubel, who was playing over in left center, and he saves a couple of runs with a great backhand rollover grab. Two terrific plays by the Twins outfield in the inning, one by Kadir and a better one by Kubel to keep the Mets off the board. As we go to the sixth inning, let's check out our Aflac trivia question for tonight. The Twins' all-time franchise record in wins. I assume that's by a pitcher?
Yes.
Not a manager? Not a particular year? Call strike to Joe Mauer. So that's career wins. Not single season.
No.
Career wins by a Twins pitcher.
I think single season and career.
There is a pretty good Twins pitcher right there. As Mauer lifts one to left field, and Ledee has room. One away. There's Burke Lyleven, who won 287 games in his major league career.
The Dutchman.
How he's not in the Hall of Fame, I don't get it.
It's a joke that he's not in the Hall of Fame.
3,700 strikeouts. He played on a couple of good teams, the 79 Pirates, the 87 Twins. But for the most part, he played on some poor teams in his career. And he still won 287 games. Big hop for Wright. And he throws out Kadir for the second time. Two away. That's eight in a row retired by John Maine.
You know, he had to do a lot of things like Walter Johnson did. He played on bad teams. Burt had 15 complete game 1-0 victories. 60 shutouts in his career.
He went 19-7 for the Cleveland Indians in 1984.
Wow. Wow.
Do you need to know more than that?
And he's only one of two pitchers that was able to get a victory before his 20th birthday and then after his 40th.
Finished up in 1992 pitching for the Angels at age 41 and won eight games that year. Started out as a 19-year-old with the Twins in 1970 and went 10-9 that year.
And for you young people out there who might not know, Burt Blyleven had one of the best curveballs in the history of the game.
There were no stopping the swing in time. One of them. Maybe. We've seen a lot less than that called a strike this year. Bill Welke with the call down at third. There's a strike, and it's 1-2. Justin Morneau, defending American League Most Valuable Player. He's going to have a tough time making it back-to-back with the start that A-Rod is off to. Tries to lay off that slider, and he did. It's 2-2.
Wasn't third base umpire Bill Welke all right in the middle of all that chatter in Philadelphia, I think, yesterday, where Charlie Manuel got thrown out and the third base coach got thrown out? I think he was the home plate umpire.
He was looking for a little peace and quiet today,
yes.
You're saying. 3-2 now to Morneau. Morneau walked his last time up, one of two allowed tonight by John Maine. Three-two pitch, fouled away. Well, the Twins scored 10 runs yesterday in beating Milwaukee, and they've been shut out so far tonight by John Maine. Kind of the way the Twins offense has gone this year. Morneau lifts one to shallow left, and Ricky Ledee has it lined up. And another 1-2-3 inning for John Maine. He's now set down nine in a row. Six shutout innings on the board for Maine. We go to the bottom of the sixth at Shea, and Maine's rolling with a 2-0 lead.
Let's check out your New York Lottery Mets box score. Bounce back nights for Delgado and Green, each with a couple of hits tonight. Delgado with his 11th home run, and Green leads off in the home sixth inning and takes a strike from Carlos Silva. Sean is 2-for-2, an infield single, then a long double off the wall in left center, and then scored a run in the fourth. Mets have had eight hits off Silva, who got some incredible outfield defense to avoid giving up a huge inning in the fifth.
Mets had two hits in that fifth inning, and the Twins made three spectacular defensive plays, each one better than the one before. 1-2 to Green. Struck him out. So Green down swinging. That's the first strikeout of the night for Carlos Silva. Time for a City Baseball Night in New York update. Let's go to the studio and Matt Yellow.
All right, thanks a lot, Gary. It's the Phillies and Indians, and the Indians getting to Cole Hamels early in this game. Kelly Shopik with a three-run home run. The Indians up 5-0 this game in the top of the fifth in Cleveland.
All right, Matt Cliff Lee pitching that game for the Indians. The Phillies start the night two games behind the Mets. The Braves just a game and a half back. Here's Valentin, who takes ball one. The Braves playing at home against the Red Sox tonight and leading Boston 3-1 in the fifth.
So Cole Hamels is human after all.
1-1 to Valentin. That's interesting. The Mets have obviously gone through an incredibly difficult time here, losing 11 of 13. But they haven't lost that much in the standings, because the Braves at the same time have lost 10 of 15. And well, the Mets at their apex were 4.5 ahead. Well, they're a game and a half ahead. So they've lost three games off their best lead. Could have been a whole lot worse.
Yeah.
As the Braves played a lot of that time, as you look at the standings in the East, without Chipper Jones, who's back now. 2-2 to Valentin.
I mean, we look at those standings. It's not really that the Mets still have the lead. When you look at the standings, what the Mets have done is allowed everyone back in the chase. It's almost like being a, exactly what I do when I go to Vegas. I amass this great fortune, and then I just give it back. That's what has happened to
that's
the Mets.
That's what it's there for. Over a short, and a base hit for Valentin. So the Mets have their ninth hit of the game. A one-out single for Valentin.
Well, this is nice hitting by Valentin. Fastball away, running away, almost one-handed it over the head of Bartlett at shortstop. Watch his follow-through, kind of loses the bat. Nice swing by Valentin.
So one out and one on. And here's Ricky Ledee, who drove in the second Met run with a two-out single to right in the fourth. Ball one to Ledee. IO Digital Cable and SNY invite you to enter the Amazing Day at Shea sweepstakes. One winner will take the mound and throw out the first pitch August 21st. To enter, go to doyoucinhd.com. The day takes a fastball for a strike, and it's 1-1. Silva's pitch count still very reasonable working in the sixth.
I like both the way he and Maine are throwing. Getting the ball, throwing it, not taking a lot of time out there.
You're saying that it's possible, just possible, that a game can be played under 3 hours?
Yeah, it's not. Yeah, of course it can be. Of course it can be. But, you know, the whole thing about pitching is you want to be consistent in everything, not only with arm angle, but you want to be consistent in the tempo of how you deliver the ball to the plate. All those things help your control.
On 2-1, Ledee fouls it away. So you're saying the goal is to not be Luis Vizcaíno.
Boy, that was it was so bad it was funny. I mean, that's how bad it was.
And yet he pitched well.
He was the difference in that game. Because Clippert had gotten hit very hard, and the momentum was for the Mets to continue to score runs, and this kind of came in and closed the door.
2-2 to Ledee, and the breaking ball misses high, and it's 3-2. Well, you got the pitcher on deck and one out. Silva not a strikeout pitcher, so.
Well, what's going to happen? You say to yourself here, you don't want to groove one, so let's say he throws one of his second pitches, changeup or slider. Even if he walks him, the assumption is that Maine will bunt. You will get the second out, and then you're going to have to get Reyes out or probably walk him, and you're going to have to get Leduca out. with two outs and the bases loaded.
Valentin runs, ball four, and the Mets have two men on. So this time he didn't give in to Ledee with the pitcher on deck. And Silva, who doesn't walk many, issues his first walk of the night as Rick Anderson, the Twins pitching coach, looks on.
That's got to be great. Rick Anderson and Ron Gardenhire, when they played in Tidewater, were best friends. And that's great that they can professionally now work as manager and pitching coach.
Well, that's a good thing. How about what happened in Baltimore today, where best friends growing up, Sam Perlazzo and Leo Mazzoni, have now been separated. Perlazzo got fired today, and the speculation is what's going to happen to Leo now with his good friend Perlazzo gone.
Well, I think that when you enter that kind of arrangement with a best friend, your manager and pitching coach, I think at some point you have a conversation over a cold one and say, hey, listen, if one of us goes, you know, you stay along. You stay with the team. If they send me away, I want you to have a chance to do the right thing.
Maine gets a nice bunt down, and Morneau makes the play. 3-4 on the sacrifice, and that moves the runners along to second and third.
Well, see the defense charging third baseman. Shortstop going behind the runner at second base. And just perfect form and perfect bunt by John Maine. Second baseman over to first to cover. 3-4 on the putout.
So now we'll see how they pitch to Reyes with first base open. Jose is 1-for-3 last time up. He drove one to right center, and Goddard made a terrific play going away to take an extra base hit from Reyes. You've got Loduca on deck, right-hand batter. They're not going to walk him intentionally. And Reyes takes the fastball on the corner for a strike.
Problem is that Reyes likes that little curveball over the middle of the plate if Silva wants to throw that. I think the problem for Minnesota is that because Reyes can lay down a bunt, he wouldn't in this situation. The third baseman and first baseman are still up. That allows Reyes to get a ball through the hole.
And of course, if you pull one or slap one by those corner infielders, that's two runs. And you see Morneau at first and Punto at third playing in.
And Ricky Ledee on second base has got to get a huge lead. Make sure that he can score in any base hit.
Kubel in left playing very shallow against Reyes. We've already seen him make a stunning play tonight. And Reyes lays off. Did he go? Nope. Held on the changeup, and it's 2-1.
Good changeup. I guess now with this swing call or check swing call, a lot of it is discretionary on the umpire. Mm-hmm.
Well, he didn't call one on Morneau, yes. And that was pretty much the same one he didn't call on Reyes. So now it's 2-1. And another off-speed pitch misses, and it's 3-1. You gotta figure that you don't want to challenge Reyes in this spot. I'd be inclined, if I were the Twins, to put him on.
I think their thought is that Silva just is so good at throwing strikes, but now at 3-1, you're right, Gary, they will walk him. And this is part of all the walks that Reyes is getting now as he gets more dangerous as a hitter.
Well, for Reyes, that's the 8th intentional walk and the 40th walk overall that he's drawn this year. And so Loduca will get the chance when the base is loaded.
Mm-hmm. Let me say at 54 walks last year, Reyes is on a pace for 100 this year.
So this is a crucial moment in the game. The Mets have a 2-0 lead and a chance to really open up some breathing room if Loduca can get a base hit. Ball is 1-for-3 tonight, but he has struggled with runners in scoring position, down to 207 on the season in RBI chances. Base is loaded, 2 down, 6th inning. And the breaking ball in for a strike.
Well, in trouble, steady diet of breaking pitches from Silva.
Pulled foul. Valentin, with that big brace on his knee, just able to get out of the way as he took his lead in foul ground.
This is why you take your lead in foul territory, because if this ball hits him, then it's not in play.
But you know what? You rarely see a guy take his lead that close to the line.
Hopscotch. Double Dutch.
So now Silva ahead on Loduca, 0-2.
He lights one into right center field, a base hit. Valentin scores, Ledee scores, Reyes to third. It's a two-run single for Paul Loduca, and it's 4-0 New York.
So you see Hunter playing. He's playing the right way, playing that way. But still, Loduca with a sinking line drive balls in front of Torrey. Two runs will score. He tries to go on to third. No chance for the runner. And good jump by Ledee. He scores easily because of the two outs. And no play at third base.
Well, that is as timely a hit as the Mets have had in some time.
But don't you, Gary, get in a position where when a team is struggling, Rick Anderson goes up to talk to his pitcher, that you start to get in that way, boy, you don't expect a hit.
Right. And also, you know, with these 1- and 2-run leads, which the Mets have routinely allowed to get away during this streak, it's a huge difference now when they're ahead 4-0.
You know, when it's 2-0 and you're the starting pitcher, as Maine is today, you still feel that pressure. A hit and a walk, a bloop and a blast, and they're back in the game.
So now Beltran, who's 0-for-3, looks to tack on. Let's see if Reyes tries to induce a balk. He's been good at that over at third base. And he takes ball one. Let's see, he's already done it to Benitez and to Tyler Clippard.
Well, Beltran's defense, he's hit the ball hard all three times in this game. Seems to be seeing the ball a lot better tonight.
Dribbles one foul. Well, the last time Castillo made that behind the back flip to get an out at second.
Silva kept his pitch count down, now 26 in this sixth inning.
Up to 94 for the game now. Mets with a 4-0 lead. The 1-1 to Beltran, and it's taken low and away. 2-1. Well, it all started in the fifth inning, that third time around the batting order. He got bailed out by his defense, but unable to hold the fort here in the sixth as Dennis Reyes gets up in the bullpen for the Twins. Beltran swings and misses. Reyes is going to hold at third, but Loduca ambles into second. Reyes came about halfway down the line as Maurer pounced on it as Loduca takes second on the wild pitch.
Oh, Reyes shaking his head like he should have come. Good block by Maurer. Using that big body to perfection. I think Reyes, if he'd gone right on, as soon as the ball hit the dirt, I think he would have made it there. It's very hard when the catcher's running to get the ball, the pitcher's trying to cover to make that exchange.
Especially with Reyes steaming in. Now two in scoring position for Beltran, but the count 2-2. Grounded foul, and they'll do it again. David Wright on deck.
Well, Loduca got a hit, and with two outs and runners in scoring position, he was only batting .171 with two outs. And Beltran, to this part of the year, .125, two outs, runners in scoring position.
Base hit could pick up a pair. Off the off-speed pitch. He's been getting some good swings tonight. That's a double phone call right there.
A black cord fever.
Steve Little, the bench coach, was on the phone, as well as the pitching coach, Rick Anderson. What does the bench coach call? 2-2. In the air, deep center field, but playable for Hunter. And that puts an end to the inning. But the Mets cash a pair on Loduca's two-out, two-run single. And they give John Maine a 4-0 lead going to the seventh. As we go to the seventh inning, let's answer our Aflac trivia question, shall we? All-time Twins franchise record in wins. Now, does that include the Senators? Yeah.
Yes.
See, that's the thing. That's the trick.
Yes.
The Twins just... So you understand the genealogy, were the original Washington Senators They moved to Minnesota in 1961 when the American League expanded, and one of the expansion teams became the second incarnation of the Senators, who subsequently moved to Texas in 1972 to become the Texas Rangers.
Now, who would be your guess at franchise? I would say it would be that's franchise history of Senators slash Twins.
Roy Hunter tries to hold the swing, and it's 1-1.
Of course, the Minnesota Twins, see, World Series champions of 24, only World Series title. Minnesota Twins had that great World Series in 1965.
Against the Dodgers. One long hop grab by Wright, and he guns down Hunter, one away. That's 10 in a row retired by John Maine. Well, 65, the Twins had that pitching staff anchored by Jim Cott and Mudcat Grant.
That's right. And they beat Drysdale and Koufax in the first two games. But Koufax found his rhythm, came back to pitch two more shutouts, complete game shutouts in that series, including, was it on 2 days rest, game seven?
Well, that's because he had missed, he couldn't pitch game one because it was Yom Kippur. Yeah. And so he pitched game two and game five, and then Walter Alston, the Dodger manager, had a choice between Drysdale on 3 days rest or Koufax on 2 days rest, and he went with Koufax, and Koufax pitched a shutout in game seven.
Big game in that series because Minnesota was up 2-0 was that Claude Osteen in game three pitched a complete game shutout, shut out the Twins 4-0.
The Twins' third start, was it Camilo Pascual?
I believe so,
the third
yeah.
starter for the Twins? Because he had been with the Dodgers.
That's right.
Pascual. 1-2 to Jason Kubel, fouled away. That Twins team could really hit.
Yeah.
I mean, they had some great offense. Zoilo Versailles, the shortstop, won the American League MVP that year. As you look at the pitch count on Maine, up to 97.
Remember, he's on 5 days rest, so he could, as Oliver Perez was, pushed maybe a little deeper into the game.
1-2 to Kubel, pulled on the ground. Delgado can't flag it down. He deflected it, but couldn't close the glove on it, and Kubel is aboard.
He overran the ball, as you'll see. He overruns it, and then has to try to make a play between his legs.
Mm. Didn't seem to have a good read on it.
Well, maybe that one, I would dare to say, that had to take a bad bounce, because you don't usually see runners, I mean fielders, overrunning the ball.
He scored a base hit for Kubel, just the third hit off Maine, snapping the streak of 10 in a row that he had retired. One out and one on for Nick Punto, who thinks about a bunt and takes a strike. That Minnesota team in 65, I believe, was managed by Sam Mealy.
Yes.
Who spent years in the Red Sox organization as an instructor and minor league manager.
Who brought the Twins to Minnesota? Was it Calvin Griffith?
He was the owner in
Washington.
Washington.
Yeah.
Foul back by Punto, and it's 0-2.
But they had Tony Oliva on that team, Harmon Killebrew, of course.
Jimmy Hall and Bobby Allison. Don Mincher was the big first baseman. Earl Batty was the catcher. And that was really their only year in the spotlight until 87 when they won it all. I mean, they had some other years in the early 70s where they were in the postseason and they got wiped away quickly by the Orioles.
Those teams
Billy Martin managed one of those Twins
right.
teams, right?
They had Dean Chance.
Mm-hmm. Struck him out. Maine gets Punto swinging on the slider.
Well, high slider. Even upstairs, it looks like a fastball to the last second. Punto just trying to put that little short stroke on it. Comes up empty.
Weekday afternoons between 4 and 6. Log on to CW11.com for live traffic updates from the CW11's CommuterCast. Check with CommuterCast before you hit the road to find the fastest way home or the easiest way to Shea. So two out, and here's Jason Bartlett, the number 8 hitter, and he takes the slider low and away. Bartlett had an infield single. Actually, it was out, but was called safe. Back in the third. And there's the former Met, Jason Tyner, on deck for the Twins. I say former Met, it's a long time ago, but Jason was a Mets number one draft pick out of Texas A&M. Going way back.
And he continues to dazzle the Twins. And, you know, you mentioned it, Gary, before, kind of a top-heavy kind of lineup. First four, five guys in that lineup through Hunter, one for 13.
1-2 to Bartlett. Well, the Twins have managed just three singles off John Maine. Walk two, struck out four. Feliciano getting ready, but Maine not looking like he needs a lot of help right now. 105 pitches in. You could see him going eight tonight if he can get an out right here. Bartlett keeps the at bat alive.
Feliciano looked like an infomercial for a core exercises.
A little different for Maine tonight. More ground outs than fly outs. He's been a fly ball pitcher throughout the season. And there's his pitch count for the night. Trying for his seventh win of the year, and he's been on top of his game tonight. 1-2 to Bartlett. Broken bat pop up. Delgado retreats. And he's got it to end the inning. So another dominant inning for John Maine. Seventh inning stretch, 4-0 New York. The Mets returning home tonight. Willie Randolph hoping to get his team pointed back in the right direction, a meeting of former Fish. And then they went to work. Carlos Delgado welcoming himself home. Pants hiked up high. Early home run. Got gunned down at the plate. In fact, the Twins played some unbelievable defense to keep themselves in the game. But Paul LaDuca with a big two-out hit to put the Mets up by four and support some strong pitching by John Maine as we go to the bottom of the seventh. And Maine 107 pitches deep. Have to figure he'll get another inning as Dennis Reyes takes over the pitching for the Twins.
Well, he's been struggling after coming back. He's on the DL with shoulder inflammation, batting average again 357, and 10 walks and 11 strikeouts for the veteran Reyes.
David Wright will lead things off in the home seventh. David is 1-for-3. Ball one to Wright.
You see that? He said, "Are you good?" When that the manager asks if you're good, you know what you answer? It's one answer all the time. Yeah, I'm good. I'm ready to go.
Wright drives one down the left field line. Foul. Well, if you got seven shutout innings going, and you've allowed three singles, and you're pitching well, why would you ever say anything else?
Yeah, of course. You want to be out there as long as you can. How many chances do you get to go out there and get six more outs and maybe get yourself a shutout? Now, will he be able to go six more outs? Who knows? You never know. You might have a quick inning in the eighth.
Wright bloops one. Morneau retreating. And can't get it. It's a base hit. Wright's going to try for two. Morneau with the throw to second. Not in time. A hustle double for David Wright. Now David took a chance and it pays off as Morneau got all befuddled.
He was used to playing hockey in Canada, not football in the United States. He might have been able to make that over-the-shoulder catch, but the key was the hustle and non-hustle. The hustle of Wright as he sees this ball drop and turn it on. And Morneau, after he missed that play, he didn't really hustle after that ball along the outfield line.
And Bartlett a little back on his heels as he received that throw from Morneau. Otherwise, they might have had a chance at Wright.
And it's hard to, you know, question the Twins' defense after the plays they made tonight, but non-play there by Morneau.
So right at second with nobody out. The Mets' 11th hit of the night. And here's Delgado, who has two of them, and by all rights should have three, except for a ridiculous play by Jason Kubel to rob him of an extra base hit his last time up. Delgado homered into the right field bullpen. Then he singled to right center before that fly ball to left. His last time up. And Reyes throws the fastball fouled away.
Reyes has now given up 21 hits in 14 innings pitched. That's tough numbers.
Reyes, the Fernando Valenzuela want to be. There is a story that came out of Mexico where Reyes grew up, that he was naturally right-handed and became a lefty to try and be like Valenzuela as Wright gets back on the pickoff toss. Now, I don't know if that's true or not.
He might. I mean, all young Mexican pitchers loved Fernando Valenzuela, of course. Looks more, a little more like Teddy Higuera to me than Fernando Valenzuela.
Milwaukee Brewers star. Wright again has to dash back. Bounced foul, and it's 0-2 to Delgado. Well, Delgado would be 3-for-3, but for this.
We talked about it that Kubel is not known as a great outfielder. He's known more for his hitting, but what a nice hustle play by the left fielder.
He had to go a long way even before he made that awkward diving rollover catch. That's a productive out for Delgado. As Castillo throws him out, and Wright moves over to third. Not what you ask for generally from your number five hitter, but Delgado did a good job there moving him over.
Yeah, that's a great job, especially late in the game. 4-0 lead. You know, he's behind the count 1-2. You know he's going to get a tough slider and able to pull that ball to second base. Nice hitting by Carlos.
So Sean Green will try and get Wright home with the Twins forced to bring the infield in. Sean is 2-for-3 today, a single and a double. Trying to get that batting average back over 300. He had dipped below it by going 0 for his last 13 coming into tonight. And facing the left-hander, who gets ahead of him 0-1. Juan Rincon is up in the Twins bullpen. Twins have a terrific bullpen led by Joe Nathan, who's probably the most unsung of the dominant closers in all of baseball.
The bullpen led the league in ERA last season, 2.91.
Of course, Nathan should be a little more sung around these parts, having come out of Stony Brook to make it not only to the big leagues, but to elite status as a closer, as Valentin waits on deck.
Well, he started his career with San Francisco, and they never knew really what to do with him, whether to start him or to relieve him, and once he got to Minnesota, he found a home, and they just put him in that slot. He's been outstanding.
1-1 to Green, and Sean bounces it foul. Green has done very well against Reyes in the past, 4-for-9 with a couple of home runs. Reyes started off with the Dodgers, played with the Reds, the Rockies, the Rangers, the Pirates, the Diamondbacks, the Royals, the Padres, and now the Twins.
I think it's easier to name the teams he hasn't played with. It would take less time.
He's a regular left-handed Mike Morgan. 2-2 to Green. Not a good day for Cole Hamels. Indians lead the Phillies 9-1 in the bottom of the sixth. And Hamels is out of there. 2-2 to Green. Up and in, and somehow he got out of the way. Green gets flipped.
Fastball, and boy, after watching over the weekend, Derek Lee get hit off the hand that was headed for his head. That was some kind of maneuver by Green, who, after seeing slider after slider after slider, he started leaning out over that plate.
But he did a good job getting out of the way. That was good technique. 3-2 pitch, bounce to third. Runner will hold as Punto makes the throw. And Green retired for the second out. I mean, we talk all the time about hitters that don't know how to get out of the way of an inside pitch, and Green showed how you're supposed to do it.
He really did. He just, you know, you just head for cover as quick as you can.
So Sean doesn't get the RBI, but he emerges with his chin intact. So it's left to Valentin with two out. Let's say one for three, singled and scored in the sixth inning. Mets with a 4-0 lead as they bat in the bottom of the seventh. And John Maine set to go out there for the eighth. And Valentin lifts one to right center field. A long run for Hunter back in the gap, and Torrey runs it down. The six-time Gold Glover able to run down Valentin's fly ball. So Wright got the leadoff hustle double, but gets stranded at third. On to the eighth, 4-0 New York. It's been Thursday evening, June 21st, with Beltran, Delgado, Glavin, Loduca, Reyes, Wagner, and Wright at the Mets Foundation fundraiser in Greenwich, Connecticut. For details, visit Mets.com or call 718-803-4074. Carlos Gomez takes over for Sean Green defensively in right field. And the former Met number one draft pick, Jason Tyner, will lead off. Never has hit a home run in his major league career. He takes a strike. He went to Texas A&M. He never hit a home run in his college career. He finally hit one as a pro in his seventh year in the minor leagues for the Richmond Braves in 2004. And he has two career minor league home runs. He can run. And he lines a base hit into right field. So Tyner comes back to Shea and picks up a pinch hit single. And we're going to check in with the studio. Time for a Baseball Night in New York update, and Matt Yellow.
All right, it's the Braves and the Red Sox in a tie game at one. Brian McCann unties it against Curt Schilling. Braves put up two in the fourth, three in the fifth. McCann also has a three-run home run. 6-2 Braves, bottom six, Gary.
And there's our Toyota National League East scoreboard. McCann with four RBIs tonight for the Braves. Meanwhile, the Indians beaten up on Cole Hamels and the Phillies. Kelly Schopek, a homer and four RBIs. Detroit leading the Nationals, who have been playing very well, 9-5 in the seventh. And after a rain delay, the White Sox jumping in front of the Marlins, who are pitching Josh Johnson tonight, his first start of the season.
Well, the young rookie last season, when he was a rookie, led ERA for about half of the year. One of their great young pitchers. And Feliciano, of course, back up in the Mets bullpen.
Castillo 0 for 3, three ground balls. And he slaps that one foul, 1-1. Well, it certainly is a boon to the Marlins to have Josh Johnson back. And, with the way the division has tightened up, Florida's right there. Yeah. They're four games under 500, but just 5.5 out of first place.
This reminds me a little more of the 2005 race, where the Atlanta Braves won with 90 victories, and everyone was bunched together. The only division where everyone was 500 or better.
Castillo swings over the slider, 1-2.
You know, Washington's played a lot better. The Marlins are back in it. Their younger players getting better with time, and of course, Philadelphia and Atlanta.
Maine has struck out four tonight. Two and two to Castillo. The Mets have played just a game over 500 at home this year. Even when they were playing well early in the year, they were fattening up on the road and just surviving at home. Now they have their longest homestand of the year to try and make some hay here against three not outstanding teams, but three teams that made it to the postseason last year.
Well, you're right. This is the time to fatten up that home record. No reason the Mets should be only one game over 500 at home.
2-2 to Castillo. Slapped on the ground. Valentin with the play. He'll have to go to first, and he gets Castillo for the first out as Tyner moves up to second.
Smart play by Valentin. He had a chance to go to second base, but with a 4-0 lead, the most important thing is to get outs as Willie Randolph makes his way out to John Maine.
So that's the last out John Maine will get tonight. 7 1/3 shutout innings for Maine tonight, and he'll exit. This call to the bullpen is brought to you by Verizon. Switch to Verizon Fios TV, internet, phone. It's the most advanced fiber optic network straight to your home. Feliciano comes on for Maine.
This copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of Sterling Metz and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of Sterling Metz.
Pedro Feliciano working for the second straight night.
Last appearance was against the Yankees, gave up a couple of runs and an inning work. He's in here to face the left-handed hitters, of course. We're only hitting 112 against Feliciano. In to face a tough Mauer is Jerry Manuel. Usually that's Rick Peterson's spot.
Wonder where Rick is. Joe Mauer 0 for 2 and a walk. Two fly ball outs tonight. He takes a slider wide from Feliciano. Well, the Mets, when they have won over the last 2 weeks, have done it with great starting pitching. And they got another great start tonight from John Mayen. Fastball in for a strike to Mauer, 1-1.
Well, he was just outstanding right after the hitters. A couple of walks, I believe. Four punch outs.
And just four singles over 7 1/3 innings. Fastball call strike, 1-2.
Interesting, I was having a conversation with John on the bench, and I said, boy, it's going to be great to play in that ballpark. You excited? He goes, well, I hope I'm still here. And that's how ball players think, right? Is that, to me, seems just a fixture on this team, but you never know.
Mauer takes the breaking ball just inside, 2-2. Well, I think that John Mayne showed us a lot last season. And not just in his postseason performances, which put him front and center in people's consciousness, but his last 12 starts last year, the Mets went 10-2. And he showed that he had the cool and the ability to pitch in the big leagues. Mauer goes down swinging. And that's the second out. Feliciano got him with a breaking ball.
Well, good breaking ball by Feliciano. Start in the middle of the plate. Ends up 3 or 4 inches outside. Nice placement.
But I think that Mayne really took a step forward this spring when he realized that he wasn't a finished pitcher and that he was very receptive to learning how to use some more weapons.
And he came to spring training ready to work. Did not assume that he had a position on the team.
Here's Michael Kadire, who's 1-for-3, and he takes a strike.
I think even more importantly, Gary, there comes a certain time that young pitchers on a team get the confidence of his teammates, and he certainly has that.
Kadire takes the backdoor breaking ball for a strike. Well, there have been very few times this year that John Mayne has taken the mound that he hasn't given his team a chance to win. And on a night when they really needed to get this homestand off to a good start, Mayne has done that. 0-2 to Kadire. Game two of the series tomorrow night. Jorge Sosa looking to bounce back from a rough outing his last time out. Will pitch against two-time Cy Young Award winner Johan Santana. Look at that record. 84-37.
That's what happens when you have a 95 mile an hour fastball and the best left-handed changeup in baseball.
Breaking ball fouled off. Well, it's not been a great year for Santana so far. 6-6, 3.19, but he's been a great second half pitcher during his career.
Yes.
Scott Schoenweiss, who had a better series at Yankee Stadium, and Joe Smith up in the bullpen in case Feliciano needs help here in the eighth. Ahead on Kadire, 1-2. Fouled away. Fair ball along the first base line. In to score is Tyner. The throw goes to second, and a diving stop by Reyes keeps Kadire from going further. That's an RBI double for Michael Kadire. When it came off the bat, it looked like a foul ball. But somehow it had the trajectory to dunk in along that right field line and turns into a double.
Yeah, he got jammed so bad that somehow it stayed fair. A nice play by Reyes. Good hustle by Kadire. Reyes getting that throw from Gomez, just keeping it in play. Never know where that would have went.
So that run is charged to John Main. An ugly run, but a run nonetheless. And now it's a 4-1 game, and you got Justin Morneau coming up. So that little flare changes the complexion of this game very quickly. With Morneau and his 20 home runs standing at the plate here in the top of the eighth. Morneau is 0-2 and a walk. And he chops one to right. He's got it on one big hop. And he throws out Morneau to end the inning. So Feliciano got unlucky, giving up that double to Kadire that brought home a run. Maine gives up one run over 7 1/3, and the Mets have a 4-1 lead. Wednesdays this summer, Daily News Live, presented by Citi, is stepping outside with shows in the SNY Studio Plaza at 51st Street and 6th Avenue. Come by this Wednesday at 5. The veteran Juan Rincon takes over the pitching for the Twins in the bottom of the eighth.
323 career relief appearances for Rincon.
And he has been a very reliable member of the Twins bullpen for 4 years now. Here's Ricky Ledee, 1-2 and a walk. He drove home a run with a fourth inning single, and Ricky takes high.
Yeah, Rincon's good for over 70 a year. Last 3 years, over 70 appearances.
Two and 0 to Ledee. Billy Wagner getting ready to pitch the ninth inning. Mets with a 4-1 lead, so if they don't score another run, it will be a save opportunity. And Ledee cranks one to deep right center field. That ball is out of here. Ricky Ledee with his first home run of the year. And it's 5-1 New York. You get an idea watching Ricky Ledee hit that home run, why he was such a highly touted prospect when he was first signed.
Yeah, when it all comes together for Ledee, it's about as beautiful to watch as any left-handed swing in baseball. 2-0 fastball. Goes out and gets it, and the power that he generates, that's just a classic, beautiful, still front leg left-handed swing.
He hit just one home run for the Mets last year in 27 games. Now he has his first of this year. And here's Ruben Gotay pinch hitting, and he takes a strike.
Watch that front arm, that right arm. Stiff, straight through the bat, and then that left arm coming through, wrapping around the body, around that core. That's where all that power is generated from.
Gotay takes low and inside, 1-1. Ruben started back-to-back games against the Yankees over the weekend, had a big day Saturday, including a home run, and he went 1-3 last night. One and two to go tie.
1-3 last night, Gary, was a good night against Wong. He just was hard to hit.
Tie goes down on the slider. That's the first down on the bottom of the eighth. So one out and nobody on. Let's check out our Toyota text poll results. Who do you think is the best home run hitter of all time among that quartet? It's pretty close.
Yep.
40% say Aaron, 35% Ruth, and Bonds, who is just 7 home runs away from the all-time record. Just 15%. Reyes loops one down the left field line, and that goes foul.
Who do you like in that group?
The best home run hitter of all time?
Yeah.
Was Babe Ruth.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel the same way, just because he played in an era where he would out-homer teams. I mean, that's just the most prolific. Put him apart from all those other players his time.
He changed the game.
Yeah.
I mean, the game was not a home run hitter's game until Babe Ruth came along. And, you know, that's not to disparage anybody who's come since. You know, Henry Aaron was a marvelous baseball player. Might have been a better all-around player than Babe Ruth.
Yeah.
But as far as sheer power and sheer dominating his era, there's nobody who can come close to what Ruth was.
I mean, you know, that would be like someone now hitting 140 home runs in a season. Not going to happen.
I mean, when Ruth hit his, I think it was 59 the year before he hit 60, the record before that was 29.
Yeah.
That would be, you know, right now the record's 73. That would be like hitting 110.
Yeah.
1-2 to Reyes. And he slices that one foul. Jose's been aboard twice tonight with a single and an intentional walk, and so that on-base percentage continues to go up. Over 400 starting tonight. In the top six in the league in on-base percentage.
Looks like the last few days too, starting to swing the bat with a little more authority.
Yeah, he was concerned he was getting out in front. I'll tell you what, that at bat against Rivera in the ninth inning on Saturday was a thing of beauty.
It really was. Batting right-handed, of course.
Pulled toward the hole, Castillo can't get it, base hit. So Reyes has his second hit of the night, and he's aboard with one out. Well, here comes Paul LaDuca, who gives us our Panasonic Plasma Replay. Panasonic for the speed of sports. Mets up 2-0 in the sixth. Two out, two-run base hit by LaDuca. Made it a 4-0 game and really changed the complexion of this one.
Now, let's not forget, Gary, this is a guy that took a heavy blow to that tricep yesterday and was probably doubtful. Most people would have been doubtful for the lineup today, but not LaDuca.
And you wonder sometimes when he's hurting whether it might even help him. And I say that because last year, remember, he kept taking that abuse on his left thumb, which eventually needed surgery when the year was over. And it seemed like every time he took a hit, he'd put together a good at-bat.
Well, I think what happens for Paul, occasionally he will pick a pitch in an at-bat to kind of go deep on or a power swing. When he's hurting, he doesn't do that at all. He just plays that little shortcut, tries to hit pitches back up the middle.
Well, both his hits tonight have been flares to right center field. And with his two hits tonight, he has that batting average back over 300. Hitting a 303. Mets with 5 runs and 13 hits tonight. One and one to LaDuca.
Reyes looks like he has no intention of running at first base.
The one time he got aboard last night, he was caught stealing as the Yankees pitched out on him. That's with a 4-run lead. This game certainly is not put away. He'd love to get another run. Now he's running, and Bauer can't handle it, and Reyes has a stolen base. His 38th of the year.
Well, they picked a great pitch to run on. LaDuca with the fake bunt. Curveball, and Maurer cannot block it. He's going to try to pick it because of the speed of Reyes. And Reyes not looking at it at all. Straight steal. In with 38. And look at the hands. Just take that abuse as he has that protection on the left hand, but not the right.
So Reyes continues to pile up the steals. Now he's in scoring position with one out. And a breaking ball hit to short. Bartlett boots it, and LaDuca's safe. Now, you mentioned early in the game, Ronnie, Bartlett, good skills, but a lot of errors this year.
Yeah, this is his 13th. Just took his eye off the ball. He didn't have to do that because what happens is that LaDuca's not that fast. He had plenty of time, but you know what happens? Reyes on second base. It looks like Bartlett tried to take just a little peek at Reyes to see if he was going to try to maybe take third on the throw. Reyes wasn't. He's playing that very conservatively, as he should.
So now two on and one out, and here's Beltran, who's 0 for 4 tonight. He's had some good cuts, though. And he takes the breaking ball for a strike from Rincon. 14 errors on Bartlett. The rest of the Twins team has only 19. The Twins have committed the fewest errors in the American League, 32. And one guy has 13 of them.
Well, old shortstop Ron Gardenhire can't make him too happy.
1-1 to Beltran. And he takes the fastball wide, 2-1.
Watch Bartlett as he comes to this ball. Oh, it takes a little bad bounce, too. The ball came up a little bit. And once it got off the heel of that glove, it was gone.
Of course, the Twins are used to playing on AstroTurf. And that's an adjustment that we never talk about anymore in the National League because there's no AstroTurf left. But they just came from home playing games on artificial turf where all the hops are quick but true.
Yeah, although they play on a different surface than they used to play at in their glory years of 87 and 91. The surface they play on now is that artificial surface with the dirt underneath
field it. Turf.
Yeah, so it's a little slower than it was when Knobloch and Puckett bouncing that ball all over the place. It's like playing ping pong. It wasn't like playing baseball.
3-1 to Beltran. That's a strike, 3-2. Of course, they still have that ridiculous roof, which led to that comical play yesterday where Lou Ford couldn't find Prince Fielder's fly ball. Did you look at that call strike? And it went for an inside the park home run. Fielder was churning.
How'd you like to be at home plate? Welcome him home.
The runners get their leads, and Beltran drives one to deep right field. That's an extra base hit. It hops up against the wall. Reyes scores. Loduca to third. It's an RBI double for Carlos Beltran, and it's 6-1 New York. Now, Beltran's had some good swings all night, and he finally gets a payoff as he hits that one with authority.
Well, this is the pitch you like to see him cover. See that high fastball away? That is the one that he should never miss. That's his power stroke, and if he had ever gotten that up, that would have been long gone, but it's just a frozen rope to right field. That's a swing you like to see from Beltran. Stayed in the ballpark instead of bounding out for a ground rule double.
38th RBI for Beltran, his 15th double. So the Mets now with a 5-run lead, and Wagner has sat down in the bullpen. Pat Neshek is up in the Twins bullpen, the side-arming righty. Here's David Wright, and he takes low. David with a single and a bloop double. 2-for-4 tonight after seeing his 17-game hitting streak end last night. The Mets have 14 hits tonight. The infield most of the way in. And Wright lifts one to deep right center field. Back goes Hunter back near the wall, and it's off the fence. Loduca scores. Beltran, who was tagging, has to stop at third on the double by David Wright. It's 7-1 New York.
Well, just a hanging slider that Wright gets up in that jet stream to right center. Ball kind of dies, though, as it gets there. And I found it very unusual that Beltran was tagging up, because that ball, you could tell after about three-quarters of the way out there that it was not going to be caught. But I guess sometimes it's on reputation, isn't it, Gary? Torrey Hunter usually catches everything, so sometimes base runners are influenced by that.
He certainly is a guy who will go to walls and climb walls. And now Delgado will be intentionally walked. And with Carlos Gomez on deck, led to the side-arming righty Neshek come in. As Rincon has been tagged here in the eighth. For four hits, a homer, two doubles, and a single. So Delgado, who had been struggling tonight, 2-for-4, including a home run, and was robbed of a hit another time. So he's had himself a big night with those pants hiked up. Aaron Heilman now on call in the Mets bullpen, as the Mets have added three here in the eighth inning to take away the save situation.
You know, with the Mets struggling to score runs, though, this is where you want to get greedy. Don't leave any ducks out there.
And here comes Ron Gardenhire, and so Rincon will be pulled. And the side-arming right-hander Pat Neshek will come on to face Carlos Gomez with the bases loaded. So the Twins will go to their fourth pitcher of the night. Mets with a 7-1 lead in the eighth. Carlos Beltran talking things over with Mets third base coach Sandy Alomar after tagging up on this long double by Wright.
Well, you can see where Beltran is right there. Now, on this particular situation, especially with the score the way it is, you probably want to be about halfway. The worst that happens is they make the catch. The runner will score from third. And you can always go back to the base still in right scoring either. Position. But chose to tag and cost the Mets a run and Wright a RBI.
Different call with nobody out?
Nobody out, yeah, it's a different call. You'd want to get to third base and get an insurance run, but they've tacked some on. And you're still in scoring position if they make the play. And like I said before, Torrey Hunter seems to catch everything. So maybe that's why he did this. Pitcher Pat Neshek, he's there. Joe Smith throws from down under. And one of the reasons he does is that he had a football injury to his right shoulder, and now he has an impingement if he throws overhand, so it made him go down under.
Carlos Gomez up for the first time in the game and takes his grand slam cut, and it's nothing and one. By the way, do you see Gomez's shoes?
I'm not looking.
No, you can't miss them, though. Base is loaded with one. Look at those things. Carlos White Shoes Gomez lifts one to left field, not all that deep. Beltran tagging. Kubel with the catch. Beltran heading home, and Kubel's throw is not in time as Beltran stumbles in with the eighth Mets run. Sacrifice fly for Carlos Gomez drives in a run. Fourth run of the inning, and it's 8-1 New York.
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. Gomez is saying to Carlos Beltran, thank you very much, as he doesn't get a lot of this slider from Neshek, but gets enough to get it out to Kubel. Good throw. Takes a while to get rid of it, but just, you know, that's just innate great speed.
I think also Beltran knew he was supposed to have scored on the previous play, so.
Beltran directing Sandy Alomar, a little traffic. Nice job by Joe Maurer trying to get that tag in as quick as he could. Boy.
Pretty close. Jose Valentin, the ninth man up in the inning, takes a strike. Valentin 1-for-4 tonight. So the Mets have busted out with 8 runs and 15 hits and lead it 8-1. With 2 on and 2 out. And Valentin pulls it right to the first baseman, Morneau, who makes the grab to end the inning. But 9 Mets came to bat. They score 4 runs, starting with Ledee's home run. Ricky Ledee's first home run of the season. And the Mets break it open. We go to the ninth. And it's 8-1 New York.
I'm Chris Cotter. Tonight on Geico Sports Night, Kobe Bryant's days in L.A. may once again be numbered. We'll explore the possibility of him coming to New York. Now let's send it back to Shea.
To get your SNY on the web, make your homepage SNY.tv, the online home of all things New York sports, pregame, postgame, every game. If you want your SNY online, bookmark SNY.tv. Aaron Hammond will try and finish things off for New York.
Well, you love this stat, 21 strikeouts to 7 walks, 3-1. The one stat you don't like, though, from Eilman, gave up another home run last night to Jorge Posada. That's 5 now. Given up in 30 and a third innings.
Does he get an asterisk in that that wouldn't have been a home run in any other ballpark?
No. He'd love one, though. He'd love one.
Torrey Hunter leads off in the ninth and takes a strike. Hunter 0-for-3. No. It's funny how the Yankees seem to hit more of those cheap home runs in Yankee Stadium than anybody else does. Jason Kubel on deck. Not that it had any impact on the result of the game. Toward the gap in right center, and Gomez gets over to make the play. Carlos White Shoes with the catch, one away. In 2007, Hyundai, the Mets, and SNY are teaming up to strike out cancer. For every K the Mets pitching staff registers, Hyundai, the Mets, and SNY will make a donation to the Hope and Heroes Children's Cancer Fund. If you want to help, please go to www.hopeandheroes.org. One down in the ninth, here's Jason Kubel, who's 1-for-3 and has the defensive play of the night. And he takes ball one. doesn't look as though the Mets are going to expand their lead tonight. The Braves now lead the Red Sox 9-3 as they play in the bottom of the seventh. Ryan McCann and Scott Thorman with home runs for the Braves in that game. Boston's hit three solo homers in that game, two by Coco Crisp.
How did that happen?
I don't know. 2-1 to Kubel. J.D. Drew has the other one. The Phillies, meanwhile, are getting manhandled in Cleveland. They're down 10-1 in the ninth. So if all of this holds up, the Mets will be a game and a half in front of the Braves and three up on the Phillies. Good changeup by Howman, and it's 2-2 to Kubel. On 2-2, Kubel takes inside with a full count. Howman trying to lock it down for John Maine, who went the first 7 1/3. Nick Punto waits to hit next. Maine allowed a run on four hits. Aaron Howman staying up, if not throwing.
Well, not that you'd ever experiment. It wouldn't be interesting to see Howman, when it comes to a game like this where it's 8-1, maybe work on pitching his fastball to both sides of the plate. Maybe using it a little more than you would use it in a circumstance where maybe, you know, you're going for strikeouts.
Back to the mound, and Howman reaches down to grab it. One away, two away. So two out of the ninth. Coming up on Geico Sports Night, following Nissan postgame live, we'll go to the Mets clubhouse for reaction. Baltimore managerial job is open. Who's going to get it? And, of course, there's Kobe Bryant and trade rumors.
Well, let me tell you, if Joe Girardi had trouble in Florida, what do you think he's going to have in Baltimore with Peter Angelos? He is a very hands-on owner.
So two out and nobody on. Here's Nick Punto. As Howman tries to finish it off, and Punto lines it to Delgado, who got the Mets started with a home run and ends it with a spearing grab of Punto's line drive to finish off the night. Delgado with a nice grab as he makes the highlight play to end the ball game, and the Mets get the homestand off to a terrific start with an 8-1 win.
I'll tell you, this was a self-esteem game, wasn't it, Gary? A game that the Mets really needed to pound out some base hits, to pound up some runs, to get some big two-out base hits like Laduca. And again, the remedy for them when they have won in this skid has been outstanding starting pitching, and they got it tonight from Johnny Maine.
Well, Maine was fantastic, but probably just as important, the Mets had a big offensive night. Delgado with the home run, Ricky Ledee with a home run, Jose Reyes with three hits as the Mets roll over the Twins. As you check out our Audi game summary, pushing John Maine to 7-4 on the year now with a 2.90 earned run average. Mets win it 8-1. Back with more from Shea in a moment. Mets baseball on SNY is brought to you by Nissan and the next generation Nissan Altima. By Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. Visit geico.com or call 1-800-947-AUTO. By Citi, let's get it done. By Hummer, visit hummer.com to check out the H3 Hummer like nothing else. And by IO Digital Cable, the leaders in HD and presenting sponsor of the Mets in high definition. Do you see in HD? Mets come home to start a 10-game homestand, and they beat the Twins 8-1 to go 8 games above 500. Be sure to join us for our next Met broadcast tomorrow night as the Mets take on Johan Santana and the Minnesota Twins tomorrow at 7. Coming up next, it's Nissan postgame live with Matt Yaloff and Lee Mazzilli. Mets opening a 3-game series against the Twins here tonight. John Maine on the mound, and he was fantastic. 7 1/3 innings, he gave up just 4 singles. Carlos Delgado came home and got the Mets started quickly with a home run. He had a big night, and the Mets were able to pound out 15 hits and beat the Twins going away 8-1 here at Shea. Now for Ron Darling and Kevin Burkhardt, I'm Gary Cohen saying so long from Shea Stadium. We'll see you right back here tomorrow night.
The same night, the Mets pitching and the Mets hitting mesh the results. an 8-1 win, one step, a baby step, on the way back. This is Nissan Post Game Live with Lee Mazzilli. I'm Matt Yaloff. Everything worked tonight. For the
everything.
New York Mets.
Let's just put it in a bottle. They got good pitching. They got good two-out hitting tonight. Delgado with a home run. I mean, everything that they did tonight, they put together, that's a formula for a winning ball club. So they had a good job, and I think tonight they needed tonight's win.
All right, Ron Darling standing by at Shea Stadium, a game that lasted less than 3 hours, Ronnie, in large part due to John Maine. Now, we've seen this theme in the month of June. When the Mets win, the starting pitcher nearly shuts down the opposition. How did Maine do it tonight to Minnesota?
Well, I think Maine has done it all season long. Think about it, guys. He's 14 starts. 12 of them, he's given up 3 earned runs or less, and how he did it was the way he always does it. A lot of good fastballs up in the strike zone that Minnesota couldn't catch up with. Good changeups to the left-hander, some really timely sliders for strikes, and that same go-after-him attitude that John Maine always exhibits, aggressiveness going after the hitters. I think Carlos Silva for the other side, he did a nice job also, made a couple of mistakes to Ledee with the pitcher up next, and of course Leduca with a couple of outs. But other than that, he pitched well, he pitched quickly, and a fine pitch game to that point, and the Mets really piled on at the end.
Yeah, perfect segue, Ronnie. Thank you for that, into Paul Leduca. In the two-hole, we're going to talk about that. I want your opinion on Leduca in the two-hole, but address this guy's toughness, because he's not a big guy, and everyone says, oh, he's a tough guy, he's a tough guy. How tough is this guy?
Well, I think he's tough mentally. Physically, he's almost all the ball players that play in the big leagues are tough. But he's tough mentally in the way that if he's hurt and he goes out there less than 100%, then he gets fine-tuned out there and makes sure that he takes good at-bats. I think sometimes when he gets hurt, his stroke sometimes gets even shorter. So he's tougher to strike out. He's going to put the ball in play. And that's the kind of at-bat he had against Silva. Kind of inside out that fastball, sending it into right center field. And two huge runs to get John Maine a 4-0 lead.
Ronnie, take us in the game. You're pitching. You're in the dugout right now. You're up a run. Here's your offense. I've been struggling for the last week or so. All of a sudden, you're sitting down, and you see your team, your offense, getting the big two-out hits, RBI hits. What does it do for you as a pitcher?
Yeah, it really inflates you. It makes you feel great because you feel like that's going to continue the rest of the game, that they got that real mojo working. And I think as a pitcher, unless you're up the bat, you're really just trying to go out to out. But it really does, just like a fine defensive play, offense getting a big two-out hit really makes you feel like you're going to get some real runs tonight and that you can be real aggressive. But, I think Maine did the right thing. He stayed in the moment, didn't care what lead he had. He just really wanted to pump strikes in there. And, seeing a team that, ironically, he had his first ever start against was the Minnesota Twins in Camden Yards, the opposing pitcher, Carlos Silva.
Yeah, how about that? And let's talk a little bit about Delgado here, Ron. We know the body of work over the years. Tonight, clearly, it worked out for him. Can a guy like Delgado take one game like this and even at this stage in his career, does he need a confidence boost? And if so, is this it?
Well, I think the entire Met team needs a confidence boost, a feeling of self-esteem, and knocking out all these hits and runs is going to give him that. But I think, listen, it doesn't matter how long you play this game. When you go through a bad streak, it really, for lack of a better phrase, it hurts your feelings. You start to feel angry,
That you're not, hurt a lot.
Exactly. That you're not getting the job done and that you're not helping your team. And no one's a prouder athlete or hitter than Carlos Delgado. So tonight, he's definitely not going to say, hey, listen, I'm back and I'm going to go on a roll. He's going to try to do the same things he did, including pulling those pants up and revealing those socks. But also, what he'll do tonight that he probably hasn't done in the last 2 weeks? He'll sleep soundly tonight.
A fashion statement, Ronnie, with the socks up high. Most of what Mets fans see of Johan Santana is through highlights, unless you're watching Twins games for some strange reason. What can we look forward to tomorrow? This guy's a treat to watch. From your vantage point, what should we look for?
Well, this has been the first season, really, where he's had an indifferent first half. He's 6-6. The team, the Twins, are only 7-7 in his starts. You're talking about a guy who throws 95 miles an hour, has the best changeup, I believe, in baseball, throws them both from the same arm slot. He's tough as nails. He'll compete with you the whole time, and he goes deep into games. So if that, if you care about a pitcher like that, then maybe you want him on your team. But, he's just, anytime he's on the mound, he makes the Minnesota Twins team a great team.
So what you're saying is it's a good thing the Mets won this game tonight.
Well, I think it was important to win this game, always to win the first game of the series. But honestly, sometimes you get more delight out of beating a really great pitcher and sometimes outlasting him than it would be to knock out 15 hits and 8 runs. If you have a chance to beat Santana tomorrow, then you're really accomplishing something.
All right, Ron Darling, it's Shea. Thanks, buddy.
All right, guys, see ya. See
you, Ron. All right, Ron Darling, when Mads and I come back, we go inside the game. If you like defense, you need to stick around. If you'd like a hitting tip, you need to stick around. The big guy is going to provide it. This is Nissan Post Game Live, only on SNY.
Nissan Post Game Live is presented in high definition by IO Digital Cable, the leader in HD. Do you see an HD?
All right, we're going inside the game. Maz and Matt here on Nissan Post Game Live. John Main on the mound, looking for his seventh win of the year. Only 1-3 at home this season. Top of the first with a couple out, Michael Kadire. The single to right drops in front of Sean Green. Joe Mauer, the defending AL batting champ, is up next. Fly ball to left center field. Carlos Beltran is there for the third out. Top of the second, no score, one out. Jason Kubel swinging at the high fastball. Nick Punto, the check swing in front of the plate. Paul Laduca makes a nice play. Laduca in the lineup despite getting hit with a pitch yesterday. Bottom of the second, Carlos Delgado up. Oh, look at the socks. Check out the fashion statement. The high socks, a 189 average in the 9-game road trip. Well, how about this? How about a home run? His 11th of the year. It's 1-0 Mets. Top of the third, Jason Bartlett, the slow roller, and David Wright makes the really nice play. And Bartlett beats the throw, but not really. The replay reveals it wasn't even close. John Hirschbeck calls him safe. Carlos Silva, the pitcher, next, lays down the sacrifice. Main gets the out. Bartlett over to second base. Luis Castillo, remember him with the Marlins? Well, this is a little shot to short. There's two outs. Joe Mauer would follow with a walk, and Michael Kadire comes up and grounds out to third. David Wright makes the play at first. Main works himself out of a mini jam to the bottom of the fourth with one out. The Sox are still up, and Delgado still ripping. Second hit of the game, Sean Green. Also a terrible series against the Yankees at the plate. This one to left field against the wall, his 14th double of the season. Delgado into third. Jose Valentin is next. Ground ball to short. They are coming home. Delgado is out.
Well, they're playing halfway there, right? And Mauer just made a great play right there, blocking a plate. And that was a contact play. You know what? We just got him at the plate.
Yeah, Maz, and those socks, they're now dirty socks. So Ricky Ledee steps up. Ricky Ledee with a base hit to right field with two outs. The Mets take a 2-0 lead, big time at bat. How about defense? If you like D, get yourself ready. This is bottom of the fifth. Jose Reyes up. Golf shot to right center field. Michael Kadire on the run. Makes a very, very nice catch. Paul Laduca next. Single to center field. Carlos Beltran now with a shot up the middle. Just enjoy. Luis Castillo behind the back gets the force out.
That's something you do in the schoolyards.
Yeah,
it?
You try it. You don't do it. You try it in the schoolyards. Luis Castillo still playing defense after all these years. David Wright follows with a single. Beltran into second base. And then Delgado's going to step up after this hit with two on and two out. Jason Kubel. Mads, how tough is this?
Oh, this is a tough play because it's a high fly ball. It's an easier play if it's a semi-line drive. But here, he made just an outstanding play and saved probably two runs right there.
Pretty amazing. He didn't break his left arm in half. Bottom six, still 2-0. Jose Valentin, a little base hit, so he's on. Ricky Ledee walks. And then John Main. You know what? He's doing his job, laying it down. Both runners move up. After falling behind 3-1 on Reyes, they walk him to get to Laduca. Oh, come on. The 0-2 pitch, the base hit on the 0-2 pitch following the intentional walk. Laduca comes through, it's 4-0. Eighth inning, John Main working on a shutout. Allows only three hits to this point. Former Met, Jason Tyner. All right, so that's the fourth hit. Then it's Luis Castillo. Ground ball to Valentin. Valentin goes to first for the sure out. Willie Randolph says enough for John Main. Well over 100 pitches, 7 1/3, 4 hits, 4 strikeouts. Pedro Feliciano comes in and gets Joe Mauer, so Willie made the right move. Then Kadire, a little duck snort, if you will, down the right field line. That scores a run, so the Twins are on the board. It's 4-1. But Feliciano gets Morneau with a ground ball to third. The Mets hold on to that three-run lead. Feliciano gets it done. Bottom eight, Ricky Ledee blast off against Juan Rincon. Ledee's first homer of the year with the Mets. It's 5-1. One out later, Reyes, the single into right field, his second hit of the game. He would steal second base to bring up Paul Laduca. Paul Laduca, ground ball, and Bartlett boots it. Everybody safe. Carlos Beltran next. That is a Carlos Beltran swing and a Carlos Beltran hit. His 38th RBI of the season. It's 6-1. How about David Wright? Opposite fields. Does it have enough? It does not. Off the wall, Laduca scores. Beltran was holding up to tag, so he ends up at third. It's 7-1. They tack on another run, and the Mets win it by a score of 8-1. John Maine, 7-4. Silva, after that complete game shutout in his last outing, takes the loss in this game to fall to 4-8. And you see Carlos Delgado right there. Some crooked numbers. That is a good sign for Delgado and for the Mets. 2-for-4, his 11th home run included. For more on Carlos Delgado and what he did tonight at the plate, we now join Maz in the locker room for a little demonstration. Maz.
Well, you know what? If we're looking at Carlos Delgado's swing tonight, you're going to see that he's really staying on the ball and he's keeping his hands back. And we isolated this on the replay. And watch his hands go back while the pitch is coming in. That's an important thing of what keeping him balanced and squared up to the pitcher. So he brings his hands back. And that's where he's going to generate all his power from. Now, if you look what I'm talking about right here, he's up at the plate. My first move is my hands are back like Carlos did. And that's keeping me square, what we call a good hitting position. Before Carlos was doing, a lot of times his hands were up, he was carrying his hands with him, meaning once I step, my hands are here. Now, when I do that, the most important thing is not only my hands are carried forward, but my head moves. And when my head moves just 2 or 3 inches, now I can't see the outside part of the plate. So when we talk about getting in a good hitting position, we go back and stay here. Now I can do anything I want. In ball inside, I can turn on it. A ball away, right there, I'm locked in, and I can stay on the pitch out there. That way, when we get into that good hitting position, there's really nothing that a pitch is going to do to really fool me. So I can stay back, generate my hand speed, and have good power.
All right, Matt. Yeah, Matt, you know what? I'm trying to take notes on this. I think I got it. I think Ricky Ledee may have been listening as well. Ricky Ledee hitting in the eighth spot tonight, gets it done for the Mets. 2-for-3, a couple of runs scored. This is a base hit with two outs, really a huge at bat with the pitcher coming up next. And then in the eighth, bottom eight, 4-1 game, he changes that, launches a rocket over the right center field fence. Then he spoke with Kevin Burkhardt after the game.
Ricky, your home run spearheads a 4-run inning. That one had to feel good for you, first this year.
Beautiful, man. I'm trying to take advantage of my, whatever opportunity come my way. It was a victory that we needed. You know, we've been struggling a little bit, and I'm glad that, you know, that I started.
How big of an opportunity is this for you? I mean, you know, you work hard in the minor leagues, you get rewarded, and then to come up here and produce and have a couple RBIs in a game like this, that's to feel great.
Yes, a really big opportunity. You know, I take it day by day. You know, I want to do my best every day. I want to be ready every day, no matter what. I was dying to play against the Yankees. I didn't have my opportunity there. But, you know, Willie told me I was going to play today, and I took advantage of that.
Was this team kind of anxious to get out there today, especially after a subpar couple games? And it must have been great to get the offense going. But how anxious was this team beforehand?
Yes, I mean, we wanted to get in the field. You know, we haven't been down on ourselves. You know, we know that we're better than we have been playing. So, you know, hopefully today is a first day of good things to happen.
In an offense like this, when you have so many hits, carry over to tomorrow?
Yes. You know, hitting is contagious. We got great hitters. You know, hopefully tomorrow we come here and do it again.
Ricky, nice game. Thanks for the time.
Thank you, boss.
Hi, Ricky Ledee with Kevin Burkhardt. You know what? No surprise. When Reyes is on base, the two-hitter does his job. The middle of the order cranks out hits like that. You're going to win games. And David Wright, a day after his hitting streak was snapped, 3-for-5, and Jose Reyes with a stolen base. He now has 38 of them on the season. Jose Reyes on pace for a monster year in terms of stolen bases. Look who's back from the locker room. It's Mazo. We're coming back here on Nissan Post Game Live. You're going to hear from Willie Randolph when we return. And then, following this show, it's Geico Sports Night. Come on back. More on Nissan Post Game Live coming up, including Willie Randolph's comments following the Mets win. But before that, we see our friend Gary Apple. There he is, burning the midnight oil. Gary is going to be joined by Chris Cotter tonight on Geico Sports Night. What's coming up, Gary?
All right, Matt, plenty to talk about on Geico Sports Night. More reaction from the Mets clubhouse after the win over the Twins. Also, what do we know about Kobe Bryant? We know that he wants out of Los Angeles. Question is, will the Knicks make a play for him? And if so, do they have what it takes to get him? Our NBA insider Frank Isola weighs in on the entire situation. Plus, a big night in downtown Manhattan as the Four Seasons of Hope charity held its annual gala. Big turnout. We'll hear from the Yankees manager Joe Torre and the former Jets quarterback Boomer Esiason, who spoke about the Jets and the Giants, and the King Arnold Palmer on hand as well. That much more. Chris Cotter joins me for Geico Sports Night coming up. For now, we send it back to Matt and, of course, Lee for more Nissan Post Game Live.
All right, Gary Apple, we look forward to that show. Mets pounded out 15 hits tonight, two of them by Paul Laduca. This one with two outs after the Twins intentionally walked Jose Reyes. Clutch hitting, that's a topic for Willie Randolph following the win.
Willie, was that Laduca hit the kind of hit that this team's kind of been needing for some time now?
Yeah, you know, big hits, big RBIs. Paulie usually is a good guy in that spot. You know, that's why I liked him in the six or seven spot. But, you know, maybe I don't know if he's just putting too much pressure on himself. But you know, he's a clutch guy. That's you know, he's one of those guys that you want to see in that spot. And, you know, big hit for us. You know, he's, you know, gathers himself. And even think it was 0-2. I think it was 0-2 count or 1-2, something like that. But he handles himself well. He's almost better sometimes with two strikes. I wish he would go up there with that approach every time. Because when two strikes, he spreads out and uses the whole field.
John, outside of the obvious win, what'd you like most about the night? Was it Maine? Was it the hitting?
Yeah, John, you know, it starts with pitching, no doubt about it. John threw the ball real well. You know, he stayed real focused and you know, kept you know, grinding and going after him. You know, pitch after pitch. So, you know, we're gonna hit. I mean, you know, I'm not so concerned about that. Eventually, you know, guys gonna start getting into a little rhythm and start to gain their confidence back. And so, but pitching's the key. And you know, starting pitching, if they keep us in the ball game like they did tonight, we got a chance to win our share of games.
You were saying before the game that you kind of felt a little out of whack, though. Like sometimes, you know, the pitching wasn't great, not hitting particularly well, I think is how you put it. So to get them both on the same night, is that a good sign for you?
Well, I was talking about different cycles, hitting cycles and pitching cycles. Tonight is a perfect example of what I was talking about. You know, you get the pitchers on the same rhythm with the hitters, and everyone makes a contribution, and you get a nice W.
Do you like the at-bats from Ledee tonight?
Well, you know, Ricky swung the bat the last time he started real well. He had a couple line drives, and, you know, Ricky, he's always ready to come off the bench and contribute. You know, he had a big home run to kind of, you know, make it a little easier at the end. But, you know, he's a solid professional hitter. And, you know, I just had a feeling that, you know, he'd match up good against this guy. And I spoke to him yesterday about him staying ready for me. You know, he hadn't played that much. We were running the kid out there a lot because of the injury he was giving us. But I told Ricky to, you know, keep working hard and keep his head up, and that I'd tap into him. And today he came through for us.
When you talk about getting out of a slump or a funk, beating a team badly that's as good as the Twins, is that a sign that you take?
Doesn't mean anything. Come out tomorrow and we got to just continue to do what we did tonight. We can't. When you're struggling a little bit, you know, you take one day and, you know, you do well. Obviously, you know, it could have been the pitching matchup. You know, we don't look at it that way. You have to go out and sustain it, continue to, you know, feed off the energy we got going. And so we'll see how we look tomorrow. Looking forward to playing tomorrow night.
Delgado had the four strikeout game on Friday. Since then, he's put together three pretty good games, a lot of good at-bats.
Well, as I was just saying a second ago, you want to keep that going. You know, you turn the page, and I don't really think that just because you get a couple of hits that you're out of the woods, so to speak. I mean, great hitters will come out of the woods, and hopefully that's where he is. But, you know, we like to look at a body of work as opposed to just a couple games here and there. I mean, it's nice to get your hits and get your confidence going, but You know, a week or so ago when guys were swinging the bat okay, he regressed a little bit. So, you know, hopefully he's not going to do that this time around and continue to stay within himself, you know, and he had a couple nice approaches tonight. He got the big home run, of course, but just continue to feed off of what he's been doing the last couple of days.
You were just talking about Leduca's hit, but, you know, for Carlos to put you ahead early with the home run, I mean, that's got to be good for him personally as well as good for you guys, right?
Yeah, sure is. Anytime you contribute and it's towards a win, it's always good for everyone. It's probably what the team's all about. You know, we like to see guys feel good about themselves individually, but ultimately, you know, it's about the team and winning the game. So it works hand in hand. You got a double treat.
All right, so that's really Randolph. You mentioned John Maine. It starts with pitching, and if that's the case, Maine started things off because he was real good from the outset. 7 1/3, wins his first game since late May, 7-4 on the season. John Maine discussed the difference tonight versus past appearances.
John, what was the difference for you tonight?
I threw a lot more off speed, and you know, I think I threw a lot more strikes with it. And you know, they're a good hitting team, and they put the bat on a lot of things. And you know, I just let my defense play.
Is your approach going in against a team like that to really make sure you get the bottom of that order out? You know?
Well, that's important for any team. But I think the key was because they made contact was to let them put them in play, try to not walk them, and they got some dangerous guys in the middle too with power, so I just try to minimize walks.
You had said a couple times that a couple of your starts here this month you were kind of close, just a thing here and a thing there. Did you feel from the get go that you were kind of on point tonight?
I think that the results and the outcome was better. I think like a lot of games though, I got away with a few pitches here and there, but I think that maybe it's things are starting to change, and for everybody, and that's what happens.
What do you think this means for the team? Get this kind of performance from you tonight. You guys score some runs with some energy in the park.
Well, it's always a big thing. Come out and win the first game, against a good team, and I think that the biggest thing is just to get back to our game. A lot of energy, and once when that happens, and it did tonight, outcomes are usually good.
Did you guys kind of exhale a little bit with the way you blew the game open in the end? Because there's been so many times where you've gotten the lead early. Did that feel good as a team?
Well, it's always good to see those runs come across the board like that. And, now the big thing is just, you just want to keep it going. And, there's a different energy out there for everybody in the team. And, I was happy with the way everything went today for everybody.
John, after the past couple weeks you guys had, how did it feel to come off to a standing ovation? Was it kind of, you guys have had a rough stretch there?
Yeah, well, a bunch of teams go through that. So, a little bit last year we did that. So, it happens, and we're just, looking forward to tomorrow.
All right, John Maine after the game. That was his comments. And backed up by the pen tonight, important to note here that Feliciano got two of the most dangerous hitters in the American League for two of the outs that he recorded. And Mauer and Morneau.
Yeah, one bloop hit over Delgado's head.
Yeah, so he did his job, no doubt. And then Heilman came in and put things away after the Mets had blown this thing open. John Maine said he changed speeds well tonight. Mm-hmm. And with a guy like John Maine, most pitchers have to do it with him. Very important.
Yeah, very important. You know what? When I had him in Baltimore, I felt that he was a guy that was going to pitch on the corners, mix his pitches up. And then when he came over to the Mets, his velocity was a little better. And he was throwing 92, 93. And I think maybe he kind of got away from him in a way, thinking that maybe he could really be a power pitcher. Mm-hmm. And I think, talking to John a few weeks ago, he was kind of saying, I got to mix my pitches up as well, too, and throw some off-speed pitches because you can't really stay. He's really not a power pitcher, although at times he can get it up there, but I don't think he can pitch there all game. So by mixing him up tonight, I thought he did a real good job.
All right, Nissan Post Game Live takes a break. We come back. Then it's Geico Sports Night. Maz here with us in Studio A, Midtown Manhattan. You're watching SNY. Up to date and hot off the presses, the Mets lead in the East remains at 1.5. The Braves beat up Curt Schilling tonight. They beat the Red Sox, while the Phillies and Cole Hamels were beat up by the Indians. Mets lead 1.5, 8 games over 500. Here's the catcher and tonight's two-hitter, Paul Leduca.
That's the type of hit that this team's really been longing for, Paul, that you had there.
That's probably the one I've been longing for a long time. I mean, gosh, I've been struggling with guys in scoring position. Bad, 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 bad. And who monkey up my shoulder, get a hit. And especially, we want them to pitch to Jose, too, in that situation. Jose's been clutch. And But, you know, I take the challenge, and I finally got a good pitch to hit. And, you know, the last five hits I've gotten, you know, three the other day in Yankee Stadium were all on the right side of second base. So, you know, that's what I've been working on, is trying to use the whole field again. And I think I got a little too pull happy. And, you know, I got a hit when it counted finally.
Seems like during the streak there's been, you know, certain players who have had real good games and things like that, but there hasn't really been that team-wide offensive onslaught as there was tonight. How good did this one feel?
Well, this is the best game we've played in a long time. I mean, offensively, defensively, pitching the whole nine yards. So, and good to see Carlos swing the bat, and Carlos Beltran swung the bat real good. He could have three, four hits tonight. And so it's good to get everybody going. And no, we know we're too good of a team for the way we played. So this is a good win for us tonight. And, you know, it doesn't get any easier tomorrow. You're facing one of the best in the game.
Was it just a matter of Maine, you know, throwing some more first pitch strikes tonight than he has the last few starts? Was that a factor?
No, I don't know. He's been good. I mean, you know, he gave up three runs, three home runs in a row, and that was it last time. I mean, he's been dominant, and he had good stuff tonight. I mean, he had great stuff. He had a great slider. We threw a lot to lefties inside and used it more as a cutter, and he had really good stuff all night. So, you know, he's got seven wins, but he could easily have eight or nine or ten. So he's been good for us all year.
Paul, when you guys are going well, attack on runs come. How important is it to have a game where you had not one inning but two innings attack on runs?
Well, that's key too. You know, we've had the lead in a lot of the games, and we haven't been able to add on. So, you know, we have too good of a lineup, and I think we've been giving away at bats, including myself. So, tonight we kept the pressure on and kept going and kept going, and that's what we did all last year, and that's what we need to get back to.
Team needs smokeouts like this once in a while. Smokeout.
It's good. You know, keeps the gray hairs away, I guess. So, but yeah, I mean. It's good to win games like this. It's good to play solid baseball, and that's what we did. We moved runners over. We ran the base as well. We did everything right tonight, and that's what you want to see.
Did you notice the Vote for Ledee campaign around Shea tonight? Did you partake in that at all?
No, I did not, and how could you not notice it? It was a little overboard, but it was fun. I mean, it's pretty fun. I had a couple of the twin hitters come up and said they voted for me before they came up to a bat, so it was pretty funny. You know, to be honest with you, I didn't think I was going to play this morning when I woke up. I went to the cage and hit, and it was bothering me a little bit. But, you know, it's good enough to play. And, you know, only one swing tonight I really felt it, but felt good. You know, adrenaline kicks in a little bit, and you feel a little better. I'm sure I'll be sore tomorrow, but, you know, it's fine. It's but I really didn't feel I was going to play coming to the park today. But, you know, the trainers did a good job, Ray and Michael, and I felt good.
All right, Paul Ledee felt good and played well, and so did Jason Kubel. Check out our Nissan play of the game. Carlos Delgado with the fly ball, and Kubel lays out and makes a fantastic catch along the left field line, saves a couple of runs, and comes away with the Nissan play of the game. Tomorrow, what a treat. Johan Santana, 6-6 with a 3.19 ERA, one of the best in the game against Jorge Sosa. Matt, Jorge Sosa has had two poor outings with the Mets. After the first one, he corrected himself real well and came back strong. Do you expect him to rise to the occasion against Santana coming off of another poor outing?
Well, you know, Matty, what he has to do is, you know, he has to think about, hey, I'm not pitching against Santana. I just got to pitch my game. If he's going to go into tomorrow's game thinking that he has to go pitch for pitch with Santana, he's going to be in trouble.
Yeah, and the coverage tomorrow begins with North Fork Bank pregame at 6:30 here on SNY. Now, later in the week, the Cyclones baseball is back. They return. They open up their 2007 season against the Staten Island Yankees. You can see it. It's 7 o'clock here on SNY. That's going to do it for this edition of Nissan Post Game Live. You're going to hear from Carlos Delgado, one of the hitting stars of tonight's game. You'll hear from him on Geico Sports Night. That's coming up with Gary and Chris next. But for the entire crew here, I'm Matt Yellow.
I'm Lee Mazzilli. Good night, New York.